Because certainly afterwards, they didn't, you know, they were all over the place in terms of
discipline, bad penalties, and that didn't give them a chance to get back in the hockey game whatsoever.
Well, Colorado needs a fast start tonight. They haven't had one in the previous two games, and the Hawks have. Ron?
All right, Ken, thanks very much. Two power play goals for the Avalanche, but they did kill off five to the Blackhawks. As for the storyline tonight, it's a change of scenery, and for that, let's go to Steve Armitage. Steve?
Ron, as you mentioned, after playing the first two games in this series in the mile-high city of Denver, we switched to lake level. Chicago, definitely my kind of town on the shores of Lake Michigan. The city with the broad shoulders, the windy city, the city of Al Capone and the boys. Over the next two games in this Western semifinal, the Avalanche, who've lived and died all season with Patrick Waugh and the big guns, want to make it their kind of town. No easy task winning a playoff game in the Big Chill against Eddie Belfour, back in nets after losing 10 pounds to food poisoning.
Oh, Eddie played really well in the first game, but we're not afraid of him. He's got to play a really good game if they're gonna win. And I don't know, he gets sick there in the second game, but Hackett, you can't really blame him for that loss. And it's gonna see tonight. It's gonna be fun though.
The Blackhawks and their fans haven't missed a playoff game in 27 years, but haven't won a cup since 61. The broad shoulders of Eddie Belfour, Jeremy Roenick, Craig Hartsburg, and Chris Chelios are now expected to deliver. Home ice could again make it their kind of town. One more time.
Well, I think we have to use it to our advantage. We've got to come out with the same starts we did in Colorado, but continue to play that way, you know, throughout the whole game. We had lapses where we had some letdowns, and Colorado took it to us. So we've got to put them back on their heels and play our type of game. And, you know, the fans will create some emotion out there. We just can't get too overexcited and try and do too much and keep our game simple.
Saw it from Messier and Yzerman yesterday. Big players have done big things throughout the Stanley Cup playoffs. Chelios, the leading scorer for the Hawks in the regular season, looks for his first goal. Chicago hosts Colorado next. Coast to Coast will have the coverage for you, and hopefully the national anthem. I'm Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
They remember the roar from across the street on Madison?
Well, I certainly do, and I'll tell you what, Ken, that was very close. Now, I don't know if they'll ever duplicate the old building here in Chicago, but hey, they tried hard tonight.
Well, Chicago became the first team to average more than 20,000 fans per game in 41 home dates. 20,000 rocking here tonight. Patrick Waugh, the second winningest goalie in the 90s, facing the winningest. Ed Belfour, back after a bout with food poisoning, forced him and Murray Craven to sick bay. Belfour, a playoff best, 1.52 goals against average. The referee tonight, Terry Gregson. The linesman, Wayne Bonney, and Brad Lazarowicz. The Blackhawks preaching discipline. No matter what the refereeing is like, the Avalanche, same story, needing a good start. Right off the bat, it goes into the Colorado zone, and Lalanen clears it out the center. That goes by Keane, and Suter takes it for Chicago. Murray Craven, who's feeling much better, although a little lighter after that bout with food poisoning, got it into the zone, and away with it is Stefan Yell for the Avalanche. Up with Mike Ricci, who had three assists in game two in that Colorado victory to tie up this series. Hawks Avalanche make changes on the fly as Uwe Krupp sends one in. He had a goal last game. Delayed offside as the Avalanche cleared it in. They move out of the zone, and Suter will feed it ahead to Jeremy Roenick. Up with Amante Andase. Roenick, Amante shooting, and that just missed the glove side of Patrick Waugh. And away with it is Claude Lemieux. Into the left wing corner, Forsberg gives chase against Chelios. Chelios feeds it ahead to Roenick. He'll turn back and spot the big rookie, Eric Daze. 6'4", Daze is now Amante. Speedy Amante gets it through to Roenick. Return feed wide of the net. Amante looking to center it. Looks back to the point, deflected before it could go to Chelios. Got it in behind the goal. Lefebvre is there. Up the boards. Can't get it past Chelios. On a second try they do. And Sakic's over the boards. Into the slot it goes for Detmarsh, who was red hot with a goal and a couple of helpers in game two. Scott Young, the other forward on this Colorado line. Here's Carney. For Chicago, who's been a standout this season, what with Steve Smith missing so many games, ahead to Probert. Probert fed one through as Patrick Waugh knocks it away. Bob Probert on the puck again. Craig Hartsburg says perhaps the Hawks' best player the last 15 games of the year, Brent Sutter. He got hit, and Young was hit by Steve Smith. Young got it out to center. Of course, Young and Smith were the center of attention as Young just hit him at center ice.
This is very similar to game one, the tempo that we're witnessing so far this first period, and the hitting as well.
Here's a puck that fails to get out. But Warren Reichel on the far boards as he's belted hard. As Sergei Krivokrasov, who just got back into the lineup for game two after being out with a knee sprain since mid-March, laid on the body. Quick pace to this hockey game. We play 2.5 minutes. We're still scoreless. The Hawks and Avalanche. Another hit at center. This one by Enrico Cicconi and Warren Reichel. And will they go at it? Terry Gregson won't give him a chance. He's taking them both. And they had a little set to in game two as well. Reichel and Cicconi got into it. No fight, of course. And now Cicconi just got an extra one. Extra. We'll see if it's an unsportsmanlike or a misconduct from Terry Gregson.
Well, Brian Burke is in town reviewing the incident, the last game in game two with Cicconi, and Terry Gregson just gave him a 10-minute misconduct in a big-time hurry, and he may not have had to say it very much, but the physical play certainly this last shift was really something to watch as both teams were hitting, being very assertive. There's a big one right there on Steve Smith as he goes down, and then Reichel and Cicconi went at it a little bit, and it looks like the Hawks are going to get the extra two for roughing.
And Cicconi gets the 10-minute misconduct to go along with it.
And a good play by Reichel to keep his cool and walk away from Cicconi. And Craig Hartsburg, he must be fit to be tied right now because I spoke with him this morning. He was so disappointed with his team. Certainly he must be disappointed once again with Cicconi as we take a quick peek at the special team so far in the playoffs of both teams.
And Colorado's power play 0 for 6 in game 1. That had been the big story. They were 2 for 7 in game 2. And of course going into game 2, Chicago's penalty killing had been a perfect 27 for 27 in the playoffs until allowing the 2 goals.
Mark Crawford with a little bit of a grin pretty early for that, but I think he thinks that this is great the way this series is unraveling in terms of the discipline. Well, looks like there's a delay over. There's the official, the linesman. I think he's getting some...
That's Brad Lazarowicz.
...medical attention.
It was key for Colorado, though, to come out with a quick start tonight because the Blackhawks in the first two games had come out so quickly, and Mark Crawford and company want to counter that.
That's right, and the lineups are for the Avalanche are exactly the same as they were the last game. Chris Simon once again is out after that undisciplined penalty in game one, and will he ever get back in the lineup is the big question. Crawford is not too pleased with them at all.
Although Patrick Waugh's mask is being fixed.
Here, I thought it was the linesman getting some help over at the bench, but it was Patrick's mask. Blackhawks, well, they haven't made too many changes either this hockey game. Patrick Waugh certainly, you know, he will be in the goal.
What a great matchup. Patrick Waugh and Ed Belfour, 5 Vezina trophies, 7 Jennings awards between them. Raw with one more of each and a couple of Stanley Cups to his credit. The Avalanche have only been outshot one game these playoffs so far. It was game one against Vancouver. They won it. Now the Avalanche working with the power play. Claude Lemieux is hit. Taken by Chelios down the ice. Patrick Waugh will have to stop that. And the Avalanche work with the man advantage. 3 minutes into this hockey game and almost a chance for Tony Amonte. As we watch the Avalanche break out into center. Roenick out there along with Amonte to attempt to kill this one off. Drop back quickly over to Sandis Ozilinc. His shot, that was stopped by Ed Belfour. Ozilinc with 2 goals and 4 assists these playoffs on the power play for Colorado, and the Blackhawks clear the zone. Joe Sakic plays the point with the man advantage along with Ozilinc. He fed one through as Colorado has to turn back. Valerie Kamensky up front along with Lemieux and Forsberg. Sacking around the boards. Ed Belfour slowed it down as Forsberg goes in on the rush, but again, the Hawks able to clear.
What the Hawks are trying to do to the Avalanche is force them to shoot it in. They feel their defense is so strong, they'll be able to get it out of the zone without any problem at all if that happens.
Here's Scott Young, Hartford's first choice back in 86. Gets it through, and Adam Dedmarsh, the speedy winger, trail BC, got the shot away. Mike Ricci on it. Gets it back to the goal to Young. Ozolinch pitching in on the right wing side. Ozolinch took a whack at it. He was stopped in his tracks by Weinrich. And it was some help from Brent Sutter. It ricochets down the ice as both teams make changes.
Watch the Hawks on their down ice pressure as well. They'll really chase.
Aggressive in all areas as Nichols almost came up with the puck. But now it's Adam Detmarsh trying to get around Smith. Knock him down to the ice. Puck back to the net. It comes to Detmarsh. Chelios clears to the far boards. Uwe Krupp moved in. But there's Chelios again to clear it.
And the Hawks are successful, killing their first penalty of the hockey game.
Benny Savard out of the box. He was serving the 2 minutes for Ciccone, who got a 10-minute misconduct. Craig Willanen, who scored that goal after the Young hit on Smith. He capitalized on that rebound given out by Jeff Hackett. And that's one thing, Greg, we may not see tonight is as many rebounds that we saw in game two.
No, that's right. Ed Belfour is very, very good at controlling rebounds.
Here's a break for Murphy, right wing side. Sent one through the crease. Waugh let that one go through to the near boards. Uwe Krupp stopped up by Murray Craven. Craven kicking at it. Gets it ahead. Nichols waiting for that puck to come loose. Murphy goes down to the ice. Craven still fighting for it. Krupp went down and now along the boards. And finally, Colorado clears. Stefaniel up on the forecheck. Craven left it there for Nichols ahead to Joe Murphy. Murphy drops one back to the point. Waugh out to stop it there for Adam Foote. Mark Crawford likes to use Foote and Gusarov against what he thinks will be the Hawks' top unit. Joe Sakic, he was stopped up. And Weinrich is hit, and here's Roenick. We'll see a lot of Joe Sakic tonight and says that gets him pumped up. That's off of Daze and into the zone. Patrick Waugh sees him coming. Puts one off the high glass. Comes down for Lemieux. And that's flipped up into the penalty box area. 13:58 to go. First period, the Hawks and Avalanche scoreless.
You know, the Hawks are going to pay special attention to a few players on the Avalanche, that's for sure. And one of them is Joe Sakic. And you'll see a lot of double teaming at times. As when the Hawks have a good opportunity to give them a ride, they will and pay special attention to them.
Tied for the league lead with Jágr and Lemieux. And he has 9 goals. That is the lead in the playoffs, 13 points, and has an 8-game point streak going.
Blackhawks as well, with not any lineup changes from the last game. Krivokrasov, who played very well for the Hawks in game two, is back in the fourth line position, and the other lines stay the same. And the defense as well stays the same. And of course, Ciccone has been the center of attention the last few days with his off-ice activities. Brian Burke is here dealing with him, and Patrick Waugh now looks like he has his mask fixed, and it looks like it was the bottom half, the throat protector. And you can see him working with the string. There's a string that keeps that throat protector on his mask, and it probably just either came loose or was cut in some way.
Well, if they didn't let him go over the first time, Patrick Waugh says, let me go over this time, I'll get it fixed the way I like it.
Well, he can go over during the commercial break. So. And here's another matchup we'll see, Sutter against Forsberg.
Sent in around the boards. Probert is hit by Ozolinch. Kamensky to Forsberg. Probert on him quickly. Chance put the puck in front. And the Avalanche clear. It comes back to Probert, but he was late coming out of the zone, and it's offside. So the faceoff will come back in the center ice area.
Well, Chris Chelios wasn't thrilled with his game the last game, and he said, you know, as a team, we lost our composure, and when we did hit people, we had our sticks up, and they weren't clean hits. Well, this time, Probert gives Forsberg a good, clean check into the boards, and that's what the Hawks will have to do if they're going to be successful. Hit, but hit properly, and still hit the key Avalanche players.
Bob Probert with just 12 penalty minutes in the playoffs, and picked up 8 of those, though, in game number 2. One on Forsberg, the undisciplined one. And the Avalanche took advantage. Sylvain Lefebvre around the boards, and Carney was going off, almost a break, but Ricci wouldn't have gotten there, as it's taken by Eric Weinrich, who had a 4-point game versus Calgary in the opening round of the playoffs, teasing him this morning about being that big point getter. Says he can do it every once in a while. Amonte feeds an accelerating Roenick across the line. 3 Avalanche to beat, turns back. That went off his skate as he tried to feed Roenick in the corner. And Adam Foote got it ahead to center, but here comes Daze the other way. Up with Roenick. to Amonte in the slot, but he was covered well. Rebound in front, Patrick Waugh down. Daze couldn't put it over top of him. Greg Miller mentioned in game two what a treat it would be for Daze to score in his idol, Patrick Waugh.
10 years of age when Patrick won the last cup in Montreal, and he was up in the stands witnessing the whole thing.
Here's Uwe Krupp. Got it ahead as Mike Keane goes after it. Keane couldn't get it through to Stefan Yell. And the Blackhawks will clear it in. Patrick Waugh out of the net to leave it. Murray Craven on the prowl. Back of the goal, Krupp around on the far boards to Ricci, who was met by Nichols quickly. Comes to the point. Held in by Chelios. Now taken by Murray Craven. Krupp on him. Dropped it back into the slot. Ricci there. Look at Chelios move in and lay on the body. As Steve Smith takes control. Keane up on him. Smith cleared it ahead to center, and the Avalanche shoot one right back in. We played just over 8 minutes of this first period. Chicago, Colorado scoreless in game three. Kucherov keeping it in the zone. We mentioned how important it was for the Avalanche to slow down the Blackhawks early. Fans wanted a penalty there, none coming from Terry Gregson. Now the puck loose at center. Jim Cummins got the shot away. Patrick Waugh able to see that and set it ahead as the whistle goes. Some rough stuff at the whistle. We're back in a moment.
Well, you know one thing that the Blackhawks for sure will try to net drive Patrick Waugh to break the way he's been playing, and it's been extremely well this series. Cummings does just that, but Adam Foote, Gusarov, well, they go right after him afterwards, and that's what starts a little bit of a scrum as we went to commercial break.
See Eric Daze, the Calder nominee, along with Ed Jovanovski and Daniel Alfredson. Gusarov and Adam Foote have been a key defense pairing. Sylvain Lefebvre's over at the Colorado bench getting a new stick. When I asked Sylvain Lefebvre about it, who throughout his career has played in key defense situations against the team's top line, actually he enjoys not doing that all the time. And Crawford's been using Gusarov and Foote out there, who've been terrific for him. Lefebvre paired with Uwe Krupp. Hawks control the faceoff. Chelios got it through. That hit a body. On it quickly is Probert. Back of the net, Bob Probert fights for that puck. Brent Sutter waiting for it to come loose. Now he has it. Sutter, he's sealed in there by Dave Hannon, who picked up an assist. He's just his third game postseason for Hannon. Acquired at the trade deadline from Buffalo. Probert centered that puck. No white jersey there. And the Avalanche clear it over the boards.
Some great board work by the Blackhawks, Probert and Sutter, and they were doing everything right down low, except at the very end, Bob Probert just threw it out. Now the whole idea is just to stay with this work. Don't throw it out at all. Just wait it out. Sooner or later, you'll get some help or there'll be an Avalanche breakdown. Just terrific work by Probert, but right at the very end, there's the blind pass. You've worked so hard for 10 seconds in the corner, 15 seconds, don't just give it away again. Just keep it going and cycling. You can see Probert right now and Sutter talking about that very point. He's just telling him, Bobby, we had it going. Don't throw it out blind. And he's saying, yeah, I know. I've been in the league too.
Off the drop, puck goes behind the goal for Wolanin. Pinching in though was Weinrich to hold the puck in. Around the near boards, there's Suter. He bumped with Keane, but out comes Stefan Yell. Yell up along with Ricci, takes the drop pass in front. What a big save by Belfour. Big save by Eddie Belfour. Sliding over as Wolanin moved in. On the other end, Patrick Waugh stopped it, and we've got a high sticking penalty coming up from Terry Gregson. And it's coming up to Colorado.
A big save by Eddie Belfour sets up this penalty by the Avalanche on the other end, but one thing the Avalanche have done the whole series is activate their defense, and it's a real concern of Craig Hartsburg because he's having a tough time with his forwards reading that the play is coming back. And now the play goes on the other end. Here's Wolanin. This is what Hartsburg's been talking about. Murphy does not have good position on him, and he lets him go right at the net. Belfour had to make a very strong save on that play.
Craig Wolanin didn't dress for a couple of games after making a mistake in game four versus Vancouver on the game-winning goal, but had a big goal picking up the rebound in game number two. As we look at the penalty, here's Ricci on Murphy. And Mike Ricci's in the box, so Chicago goes to the power play, 0 for 5 in game two. 6 of 31, 7th in the National Hockey League playoffs. Suter gets to Chelios and gets a return feed. His shot blocked. And there is Mike Keane to send it down the ice. He and Stefan Yell, the top penalty-killing unit for Mark Crawford. Belfour handles that puck so well, gets it around to Jeremy Roenick. Roenick up front with Amonte and Daze. Roenick accelerating to the Colorado line, now to Amonte. Back to the point it goes, Chelios settles it. A bit out of Suter's reach though. And getting over there is Mike Keane to knock it over the glass into the seats. With 10:05 left first period, 1:30 in the penalty.
Again, the special teams in this situation are very close. Both teams have done well in their power play and penalty killing units. And Chris Chelios told me this morning as well about the power play. He said, well, we have to do what they give us. In other words, or take what they give us. Certainly in game two, they adapted extremely well, the Avalanche, by moving their forwards up very close in Chelios and Suter. They did it again this last sequence here.
So Daze, Roenick, and Amonte stay out there for Chicago as Chelios was sneaking in on the right side with the Avalanche control. And now Chelios will go back to get it from Ed Belfour. Roenick circles in behind him. Out at center, Forsberg was up quickly on the play, and again the Avalanche sends Chicago back. Dave Hannon, who's been an extraordinary penalty killer throughout his career. Hannon with a cup ring from the Oilers in 88. Roenick lost it at the Colorado line, but goes in after it. Lefebvre and Roenick bump. Daze grabs that loose puck to Suter, quickly to Chelios. On him is Keane. Side of the goal, Daze looks in front, Roenick, nice tip, Chelios to the point, Suter scores!
Well, Ken, it might have been Suter shot from the point, but it definitely hit something in front. Daze was there, but how about this play by Roenick? Just to tip it through to Suter, he shoots it. Now right there, did Daze get a stick on this puck or not? I am not sure. But nevertheless, the whole play right here is Roenick. He knows that both Colorado players are on top of him. That means Suter must be wide open. And look at the traffic in front of Patrick Waugh. And yes, it hit something, and I'm not sure what it hit. Nevertheless, there was excellent traffic by the Blackhawks in front. And a good goal by Gary Suter. Yes, he will get credit for it.
And Jeremy Roenick picks up an assist. He has a point each game in these playoffs. Now with 8 for him. And Chicago has scored first in both games of this series. Colorado has countered each time with quick goals and a short span. So Suter for Roenick and Daze at 10:39. It's 1-0 Chicago leading, 8:50 to go, first period. Gary Suter on the bench, and his goal is second in the playoffs, giving the Hawks the lead.
Let's see what this hit. Geez, I still think that may have hit Daze in front, or maybe it went between Patrick's legs and then hit something and went to the upper half of the net, but it doesn't really matter. The Hawks are up 1-0, and that's the main thing if you're a Hawk fan.
Gary Suter tied for second in scoring in Chicago during the regular season with Jeremy Roenick. Of course, Chris Chelios led the way in Hawks scoring. First Hawk to do so is Belfour, had to make that save right off the draw. Forsberg got it through to Lemieux. Turning with it is Kaminsky. To Lemieux as they look to cycle that puck. Taking it away though is Brent Sutter, and we'll see this matchup a lot tonight. Sutter, Probert, and Chance against the Kaminsky, Lemieux, Forsberg line. Here's Kaminsky looking to center. Brent Sutter, though, will skate away for Chicago. Sutter hit by Forsberg, and he can lay on the body. Carney fed one through for Chance. Lefebvre and Ozilinch, the defense pairing for Colorado. Probert going after it. Ozilinch up the boards. Kept in, though, neatly by Chelios on a first try, but now Carney has it. His pass offside at center ice as Bob Probert touched the puck. Faceoff coming up. Hockey game, the Hawks have won 6 faceoffs to Colorado's 4. The Avalanche control that one and send it in. Smith got it ahead to Nichols. Right wing corner, Joe Murphy giving chase against Craig Wolin. He's bumped back of the net and Colorado skates it out, Joe Sakic. 9 goals, lead playoff scores, Sakic into the corner. Looks to center the puck. That's deflected down. Raven couldn't control it. Deadmarsh steals. Deadmarsh gets it through. Belfour got that stick down in an old fashion that he likes to knock it away. Raven stood up at center ice and a nice hit by Craig Wolanin. Uwe Krupp. He'll just send one back into the Chicago zone. Belfour coming out to play it, thought better of it, but a good play by Reichel to negate that icing call. And it's almost lost in the slot by the Hawks and just thrown out to center by Tony Amonte. And Daze touches it, so on that hand pass, the faceoff will come back into the Chicago zone. Well, game one, Colorado is Jeremy Roenick the hero at 6:29 of overtime against Chicago, grabbed the lead in that one. Colorado came back, took a 2-1 advantage, ended up going to overtime, and game two was all Colorado again after a Chicago 1-0 lead.
Daze, who was very, very strong in game two. We'll have a look here at the defensive pressure right here, or the offensive pressure by the Hawks. Really forechecking so far this game. And look at the third man, though. Perfect position to create a three-on-three after the good forechecking by the Hawks.
Lucerov at center. That pass went off his skate. Goes to Adam Foote. And now the Avalanche will go in after it. Ricci along with Keenan Yell. The Hawks, Daze can't clear. Avalanche control. Side of the goal, Keen. Look to center it back. Stefan Yell to find Rookie in to help. Keen, he's sealed to the boards by Suter. Loose puck picked up by Ricci. Ricci, he's taken out of the play by Amonte. Now circling in front. Oh, Keen just missed getting his stick on that. Lucerov pitching in from his point position. Ricci hauled down by Amonte and a penalty coming up. Colorado applying the pressure and the Hawks will pay for it.
Well, I mentioned earlier in the first period, if you have your cycling going, don't give it away unless you have a good opportunity to find somebody to either shoot the puck or cycle it again. And this is exactly what the Avalanche do here, and that creates a penalty as Amonte just hauls down Ricci. But that was all from good cycling and not giving the puck away down low.
Tony Amonte had the lone goal in game two for Chicago. This guy had just four goals prior to December 20th, then rattled off 21 in 26 games.
Greg Hartsburg felt if they had Roenick and Daze with him all season long, his numbers would have been much better.
So Brent Sutter will face this one off against Joe Sakic to the right of Ed Belfour. 1-0 Chicago leading, 6:24 to go, first period. Sandis Ozolinch to Forsberg. Looking rink wide, the shot through by Sakic wide. Kaminsky with Lemieux in front. Took a bit of a cross check from Steve Smith. Paired on the fence along with Chelios. Looking in is Ozolinch, sneaked in from the point position. His centering pass deflected. Now Sakic, that held it in. That was deflected too and up into the seats. As we look at Chicago defenseman Steve Smith, who missed 42 games with a sore back. And he's our subject of Stanley Cup engravings this evening. He was slashed back on April 7th. The big controversy, of course, the officiating Chicago and Bill Wirtz and Igor Larionov slash. But what a recovery he made, from the fractured fibula.
Terrific. He says he's still having a little trouble turning, however, and that's a little tougher when you go back for pucks because instead of winning the race back to the corner, at times it's just a tie. But other than that, he said it's pretty good.
Actually, when Enrico Ciccone jumped on him after scoring his first ever playoff goal back in game one, he was worried that he hurt Smith's back again. And Smith said he felt a bit of a twinge go when Ciccone jumped on him.
We'll see how that when this series progresses in length, how he reacts, Smith. It's easy to play the first few games in adrenaline, but then conditioning comes into play, and that'll be tougher on Steve Smith as the series progresses.
Mile high atmosphere in Denver, though, said he was okay for not being probably in the best of shape. 1:30 to go in this Colorado power play, looking to get even with the Chicago Blackhawks. Suter scoring on the power play, 10:39 into the first period. Here's Claude Lemieux. His shot deflected off the high glass behind Belfour. Nichols can't clear. Had a chance. Kaminsky, though, with it. He feeds off. Forsberg in front, goes through. Belfour loose puck. Lemieux banging at it off the pass in front from Sakic. But the Hawks clear it out and hold on. Right now, while we have a chance, let's check in with Steve Armitage.
Thank you, Ken. I'm with the goaltending consultant of the Chicago Blackhawks, Vyacheslav Trechak. And Vyacheslav, you were just telling me the difference in this series could be the goaltending of Patrick Roy and Eddie Belfour.
Yeah, we watched today two good teams, Colorado and Chicago, same level. Who is play goalie? If you goalie play very well, and team win, I think so.
How fit is Eddie Belfour after that food poisoning?
Eddie, I like him because good athlete. He work hard every day. Sometimes I say, hey, Eddie, relax sometimes because today playoff maybe tight. Last love. I'm not tired. I would like play same you. I would like win Stanley Cup. Okay, work hard.
But he did lose a lot of weight. Is he strong?
Strong. Strong, guys. Strong. He's strong.
How about his concentration and focus?
Sometimes regular season, Eddie, sometimes no good discipline. You like fight a little bit. And in the playoffs, different hockey is very important, focus in the puck.
Thanks very much, guys. Back to you.
Playback underway. Sakic moves the puck through. Scott Young reaching in front. Young feeds it off. Sent back to him. Centered in front. Olsalin coming up. That puck batted away in front as Detmarsh had a shot. And Chelios will settle it. He'll try going the other way. Held in at the point though by Sakic. Still there, and now the Hawks able to clear. 35 seconds left in the Colorado power play.
A lot of little crease plays around Ed Belfour where he had to be very, very sharp in getting that stick down, like you mentioned, to make some key saves down low.
And Young's getting the gate for Colorado. Scott Young is going off.
And here's what I'm talking about. You see Chelios, how strong he is at trying to get passes and through creases, but look at Belfour here. He's battling. The Hawks are really collapsing down low, and there's been a lot of this little stuff in front of Ed Belfour all of this first period when Colorado's been on the power play.
Well, Young's got a roughing penalty, so in 27 seconds, when Tony Amonte gets out of the box, Belfour and the Hawks will head to a power play.
And just listening to Trechak and his comments about Eddie Belfour, most people do not realize what great friends these two are. They go to dinner together on the road, and they do all kinds of things. In fact, in the summer, they even have a hockey school together. So they're very close friends, and Eddie Belfour has so much respect for Trechak, and he's been a big part of Belfour's career in the National Hockey League.
So Ed Belfour, albeit a bit lighter, with that equipment at the end of the game, he'll be a lot heavier.
Well, he told me he loses between 8 and 10 pounds a game in water as well. So if you add on 8 and 8, well, a lot of weight loss.
He only played 49 games this past season, fewest in his career, so not as tired as he has been in the past.
And he says he's never been hurt as much as he has been, so he'd rather play, I think.
Teams at four aside for another 17 seconds, and Chicago will work with the power play. Giveaway again inside the Blackhawk zone. Kamensky looks to capitalize as Murphy copped it up. Back into the slot, the shot, Sakic rebound, and Belfour stops him. 4:26 to go, first period, still 1-0 Chicago. Coming up in our first intermission, Don Cherry in the coach's corner along with Ron McLean. Just 4:26 from now.
Ed Belfour has been outstanding this first period. How about this anticipation right here on Sakic, who gets it away in a hurry, but Belfour is sliding right across to anticipate the play. The Avalanche have some room up top, but as Sakic told us a few days ago, it's have to be a perfect shot, and it's a tough shot to make. We know we have to go high, but Eddie's such a big goalie up top as well in his upper body, it has to be a perfect shot, and that's the way Belfour plays it.
Yeah, Sakic saying looks easier than it really is when you're in tight quarters. While Steve Smith and Adam Foote have gone off for unsportsmanlike conduct penalties, Terry Gregson not putting up with anything tonight. So in 2 seconds, as Tony Amonte's up in the box, Chicago will head to a power play, and now they are. Pass out to Amonte, just missed him, and instead it'll turn into an icing as the faceoff comes back into the Chicago zone. As we look at Patrick Wiley, Colorado Avalanche, and we see his record. Billy Smith leads in all-time playoff wins. Patrick Roy right there in fourth with 75. And making his 123rd playoff start tonight. That second to Billy Smith. Hawks now look to get it going with the man advantage. Suter firing one in. Patrick Waugh couldn't settle it back to the net. Eric Daze does to Chelios. Now to Suter. Scores from there first. And that shot just missed. Great chance there for Amonte to put the Hawks up by a deuce. Comes around to Suter. To Chelios, to Suter. Suter again. Now Roenick. One-time shot. Patrick Waugh isn't sure where it is. Just stays where he is, though. And the puck's underneath.
Well, Hawks are playing it very smart so far this hockey game on their power play, because they're moving the puck from the blue line and then moving it down low. So they have two options going, either the Chelios and Suter point option or the Jeremy Roenick and the seam option. And you can see what they're doing. Here's the first one here, Chelios to Suter. And there's the low option that's open, and Amonte cannot find the handle as he has an excellent chance to score on Waugh, who's down on it. Amonte would love to have that one back.
Nichols up front, along with Murphy and Craven on the Chicago power play. But a two-way group controlling for Colorado. Off the boards and down. John Klemm, his first shift. Out there for the Avalanche. Mark Crawford really likes John Klemm. Still classified as a rookie, even though he's 26 years old. Nichols, he's pushed into the boards by Krupp, but Craven picks it up. Craven looked to the point, didn't get it there. Over there is Hannon, he can't muscle the puck out. Good job again by the Hawks. Captain Chelios to keep that puck in. On the near boards, Klemm banging at it. And away comes Krupp, it's a two-on-one along with Hannon. Catching up those Craven. Krupp, backhand passes in front. Hannon couldn't find it as Craven got back. Now Suter. As both teams make changes. In back at full strength, in behind the goal. Chance can't come up with it. Puck on the back of the net. Knocked down by Lefebvre, still there. Gusarov tried to pin it. Now Lefebvre, as he and Probert fight. Probert comes up with the puck. But Lefebvre stayed with him, knocked him down. Another penalty that the fans wanted here at the United Center. Right wing side for Scott Young. Young, he's hit hard into the boards by Suter. Oh, is he whacked? Now Probert comes in. And no call from Terry Gregson on the first hit. That's Suter put on him.
And he's hurt. Young is down. And all the players are around him. You can see the linesman trying to protect him. And Suter really gave Young a ride into the boards. And it looks like he's all right. We'll see if this is boarding or not.
It almost looked like Young's a marked man for the non-call from game two nights back.
Pretty good body check, really. Yes, it was into the boards. Young was a little bit off the boards, but I don't think he was off far enough to warrant a boarding penalty. That's just good, tough hockey.
As we get another look at it.
That was a dandy.
So Gary Suter has the goal and also has the tough hit of the night.
Earlier on, Suter did, however, make a mistake, as you see Young's cut. But watch how Chelios here angles the player to the side and then slides so the pass cannot be a perfect one to the open Avalanche player heading to the net. Ooh, and you can see the nasty cut right here as Young's head must have gone, or it did go into the boards. And
it went in hard.
That might be a pressure cut, as they call it. Not that I'm a doctor by any means.
Right in the helmet's done up tightly enough. Chelios beats it around for Carney. One of only two Hawks along with Suter to play all 82 games this past regular season. Chelios, two-time Norris winner. He took a bump from who else? Claude Lemieux. He also cross-checked him hard in game one of the series from behind. Lemieux got Chelios right in the small of the back.
Yeah, but Chelios got him back later in the game with a cross-check.
Icing call. There's Chris Chelios, a man that Craig Hartsford feels is the MVP, and no defenseman has won the Hart since Orr in 71-72. Of course, Chelios won't this year because he's not nominated.
And Here's what you were talking about, Ken. A good hit by Lemieux on Chelios, and the Avalanche know that they have to try to make contact with Chelios as much as possible, particularly when he plays so much, 30 minutes a game plus, and the only way to wear him down is to get on the body, because you know that Chelios is used to the ice time.
33 and a half minutes playing time for Chelios in game one, 29 and a half in game two, because at that point the game was pretty much out of reach. But he's used to 30 plus a night. Smith shot, that deflected wide before it could get to Patrick Waugh. Olanen hit Amonte in the corner, gets it back to the point, but Weinrich hit, pinched in, and now he'll knock it ahead to center. Here's Eric Gaze, left wing side. Gaze got it into the slot, Gusarov is there. Gusarov gave it away, Amonte almost stole it. Gusarov's foot is the duo that Mark Crawford wants out there, but it almost cost them that side. Mike Ricci sends one in off the glass, Mike Keane moving in. Back of the goal for Yell, Warnick tying him against the boards. Ricci pushing in there too, Terry Riggs still sees that puck. And Weinrich pinches Ricci. Ricci trying to skate it free. Kicking at it, comes along the near boards. And Amonte will clear it out the center, moving up on it is Steve Smith. As the Hawks are changing, Smith senses that and just sends one in. Gusarov, in front of his own goal to Adam Butch. That pass too far for Joe Sakic. Sent ahead, now stolen by Young, who's obviously okay in his shot. That missed the glove side on Belfort. Deadmarsh moving up. Back of the goal and around to the far side. Murphy will settle it. Get it out for Craven. Time winds down in this opening period. Back with it is Carney. Out to center. Nichols can't get anywhere. Craven bumping along with Lemieux. They have words. As the first period comes to a close, and now Krupp is into it as everybody gathers. Carney and Wolanin mix it up.
A little face wash here or there. Smile. That'll be about it.
As they step in, and neither bench has departed yet, but at least they haven't come onto the ice yet.
And they're calling for Eddie. He looked like he was going to go over to the scrum for a minute, but then he decided that that may not be such a good idea and went over to the players' bench instead.
Well, so far still in no hurry to break this one up.
Of course, Chelios and Lemieux are still going back and forth as well.
So the only goal of the first period, a power play marker from Gary Suter. Shots on goal, Colorado 8, Chicago 5, but the Hawks lead.
Coach's Corner with Don Cherry. Brought to you by Green Cross. First aid for lawns and gardens.
Eddie Belfour is looking pretty good considering he was sick on creamy potatoes.
Creamy potatoes, is that it?
That's what happened in Denver. He and Murray Craven both had it. You ever have it?
I had it when I played. I remember one time Rose poisoned me.
Good.
No, it was with turkey. I had some old turkey. Funny thing is, her and Tim and Cindy never ate it. I ate it, and they had a party. We had a party that night, and I remember the guys are downstairs. It all comes back. They were playing Luai, Luai, and the face was jumping, and every time they threw, they go zzz, back
why,
again.
Why wouldn't you cancel the party if you were sick?
Ooh, you didn't cancel parties in those days.
What did you think of the first period?
I want to show you something, folks. The score is 1-0, and you're wondering what's wrong with hockey. Watch this penalty on Ricci. Watch this here. Go ahead, and you'll see. This is 1-0, puts the team behind. Now watch this. This is a penalty. I mean, does that not drive you a little nuts or what?
But there were a couple of good hits. I thought Gregson let him go toward the end of that period.
Certainly
they
did.
They have to clamp down now. What do you think of that series? Any thoughts on how it's going to go from
here? Well, I don't know how it's going to go. I still like Avalanche. They've got a lot of zing, zing, zing. They got a lot of things, but I love that Chicago heart. They got the grit and everything. Like they play, like I said before, like my Bruins, and I like them.
What did you think of the game yesterday? Detroit rolls over St. Louis, and we buried Wayne.
Yeah, well, your tribute to the Russians was great. Now, let me get this right. The Russians are great, eh? That's all I heard, how they were great. There was 13 power plays for Detroit. By the way, what have they got? They've got something like over 20 power plays.
22 in the series.
22 power plays in two games. Anyhow, they have 13 power plays. They play on the power play. They got one goal. That's all they got. So, you know, what are you going to do? I mean, it's sad to watch.
Shane Corson's been great.
Shane Corson's been good, but it's going to be tough.
I thought, I know you love Steve Yzerman, but he was great yesterday.
5 points. He never even mentioned him. I don't know. I don't get it.
Are they done? St. Louis toast?
No, they're going to win a game. I think they're going to win the next game.
All right. So you give them five. Oh, generous. How about Pittsburgh and the New York Rangers? Mark Messier leads New York back.
What a guy. They're down for 4 minutes in a big game like that. And who kills the whole 4 minutes almost is Messier. What a guy. I'm betting Barrasso will be back in there. They were just waiting for Reggett to have a semi-bad game, and he'll be out.
I don't know if his back's up to it, though. They say it's probability.
Well, if he can get back in, he'll be back in.
What do you think about Mario Lemieux, Yarmer Yager? You think they can turn that thing around?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not too interested in that series right now.
Okay, what about the Philadelphia Flyers with Eric Lindros rolling into Miami?
Eric went to war. That's the way you – yeah, they're a little bit mad. I'm very, very surprised that Doug McClain, coach of the year, complaining after a game. You know, and I hear they went to Bettman and they went to this about Eric and like that. You know, When I had the Bruins, and they were supposed to be kind of like tough like that, you never sent in videos, you never complained, you took care of them. Eric was there. If you want him, he said, here, he stood in front of the bench, hey, you want a piece of me, take me. I don't like that they're complaining to the referees.
I don't know that it was Doug McClain, though. There was a story in the Miami Herald complaining about three players cut, and he was asked about it and said he wouldn't comment.
Oh, yes.
Said, all I know is we had three guys cut one guy hit over the head.
You're going to see a lot of cuts, as I've said before, many, many – Well, three guys cut in one game. A guy cut tonight, but, no fights.
Right.
No fights. Lots of cuts. Lots of injuries, but no fights.
What's with the hat?
All right, let's go with Team Canada. That's why I came here. I was trying to get it over with as fast as I can. Anyhow, we're very, very proud of them. We got to give the Czechs, a lot of credit. They won it fair and square, but it's very, very tough. I coached Team Canada in the World Tournament over there. What do they call it? World Tournament?
World Championship.
World Champion. No, the World
Not to be confused with the World Cup. World Championship of ice hockey.
Oh, ice hockey,
yes.
Is it? Yes. Anyhow, they won it fair and square. They played a very good game. Tom Rennie's going to be congratulated and assistant coaches. Andy Murray?
Murray was on the bench. I don't know. We'll have to ask Curtis Joseph's coming in tonight.
Yeah, I know how tough it is there because I was over there. We have 4 days. They're together 4 months. Did a great job. No complaining, but wasn't it great, folks, to watch the German referee? That game was over 2 hours and 15 minutes. There was only one dive he called, and that was to even up. It was perfect. We've come 180 degrees. Now, let me just tell you, when we were over at the World Tournament and Team Canada, we used to laugh at the referees from Europe. They'd call every little chintzy penalty, as I'm seeing, and like that, and it used to be a joke. We could hardly wait to get the NHL referees. Now, watching that German yesterday in a great hockey game. That was a great hockey game. He doesn't call a chintzy penalties. Now over here, we got like 20 power plays in one game. It's come full circle. I'll tell you, boy, I remember when I was over there at the World Tournament, the heart and soul of a Canadian character. Those kids, you see them crying after? I tell you, boys, we all loved you. You did your best, and don't be ashamed of the silver medal.
You know what, I agree with everything you said, especially the referee. The only chintzy call was Paul Kariya took a bit of a dive.
Yeah, but he did that
perfect.
Smart.
Even
yeah.
Yes.
That's the point. He did it perfect. He evened it up. And I know you people say he shouldn't even it up, but he did not want them to lose the game. And Kariya took it. He evened it up. Beautiful. That's the way refereeing should be, and that's the way it used to be.
I have a little riddle for you. Do you know what you and Eddie Belfour and Murray Craven have in common?
What?
You get upset at commentators. Don Cherry in the Coach's Corner on Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
Turkey.
Yes, cold turkey. I can imagine you get sick crying.
Coach's Corner on CBC. Brought to you by Green Cross. First aid for lawns and gardens. Stanley Cup Engravings. Brought to you by Ford Motor Company of Canada Limited. Proud sponsors of the Hockey Hall of Fame and makers of the 1997 F-150. Built for today's driving needs.
Tonight, trying to erase a painful memory.
heartbreak for Steve Smith before getting his name on the cup. April 30th, 1986, Smith scored into his own net in Game 7 of the Campbell Conference semifinals. The goal turned out to be the game winner, allowing Calgary to upset the defending Stanley Cup champs to advance to the final, an agonizing situation for the rookie. The next year, the Oilers regained the cup. Wayne Gretzky made sure that Steve Smith was the first Oiler to hoist the cup, helping erase the painful memory.
Stanley Cup engravings, brought to you by Ford Motor Company of Canada Limited, proud sponsors of the Hockey Hall of Fame and makers of the 1997 F-150, built for today's driving needs.
Chicago's been outshot in five of their six games, and were outshot 8-5 in the first period, but lead 1-0, and whenever they've won the first period, they've won the game. Four of six times thus far in the Stanley Cup playoffs, the Hawks have done that, and they're up one as we go back to the rink next on Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
This portion of Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC is brought to you by Ford Motor Company of Canada Limited. And buy Pepsi stuff. People who drink it, get it.
Well, play just underway. Second period here at the United Center. As Scott Young puts a hard hit on Gary Suter. And we saw those two collide earlier with Young on the receiving end. The Chicago Blackhawks with a 1-0 lead on Colorado. Offside pass to Eric Daze. Daniels along with Greg Millen and Steve Armitage. And this is how the scoring went. 10:39 of the first. Suter, a power play shot that got through Patrick Roy with Colorado out shooting Chicago. Greg Millen, how do you think the first period went for both teams? Would they be happy?
I would think so. Other than the power play goal by Suter, it was a very even period. Some good saves by both goaltenders. The chances were even. The faceoffs were even. And the only difference was the goal by Suter.
And we had talked about Colorado coming out and not getting off to good starts. And wanting to get through at least the first 10 minutes, quiet the crowd a little bit at what is always a noisy United Center. And to some extent they did that. Got through the first 10. Suter scored at 10:39, so just about did it. Volanen couldn't knock that puck down. Perfect. He shoots one in, but Kupel turned for Colorado. Got it ahead to Lemieux, and it goes back to the Chicago line. Ciccone. He's been asserting his 10-minute misconduct. Hits it around. And on the near side it comes, giving Chase his chance, but Lefebvre had it. He gets that puck ahead, and Claude Lemieux skates it into Chicago territory. Belfour made the save. The rebound gobbled up by Sutter. They almost kept in at the blue line, but deflected up into the seats.
Well, Craig Hartsburg would like us to say to his son, Chris, who's watching Hockey Night in Canada tonight in Cambridge, where he played hockey this season, and he just tried out for the under-17 team on the weekend. So, hello, Chris, from your dad.
Craig Hartsburg hired June 29th on his 36th birthday. And there's Mark Crawford, last season's Jack Adams winner, also an Ontario boy is Mark Crawford.
It's been a good coaching matchup for sure. Once again, early in this second period, there was a quick change by Crawford to get Forsberg out there, and then another quick change by Hartsburg to get Sutter out there. We've seen a lot of this so far in the series. And here we go again as the Avalanche are heading for the bench. And Crawford said to me, he said, you know, our team hasn't had to go line for line all season long, and he feels that the Blackhawks may have a little bit of an edge in that department. Because certainly the Blackhawks have been going line for line. But one thing it does at times is it upsets players. Well, you can see why here is Lemieux gives them a little shot. And he goes off and gives them a little shot back. Tit for tat.
Well, always good for a Sutter and a Lemieux. It's to be expected.
Absolutely.
To go at one another. Some will say that's hockey. So Bernie Nichols on this faceoff against Joe Sakic. On those rare occasions we don't see Jeremy Roenick against Sakic. The more you play that, the less ice time for a large part that the Nichols line is.
Yes, but you have to be careful when you're the home coach not to get caught up too much in line changes, because at times it'll keep your best players off the ice.
That's sent in, and Belfour will hold on for a faceoff coming up to his left.
talking to Bob Murray, the assistant GM, about Ed Belfour between periods, and he said to me, you know, Eddie is such a competitive guy that he can't afford to relax. And when you get a little bit older at times, sometimes maybe you just lose a little bit of an edge during the regular season that you don't have when you're young and enthusiastic. But he said, now it's playoff time. Eddie's intensity has gone up a notch, and he's been really pleased with his play. And, of course, Hackett, I'm sure, was disappointed in his game in game two when he was thrown to the Wolves, but really couldn't fault him in any of the goals.
It's his third playoff appearance for Hackett. His first start, Raven tried to work around Group. He couldn't. 6'6", 235-pound defenseman got in front of him, and now he joins the rush. Uwe Krupp, who is going down opening night, forced the Owen Nolan for Sandis Ozilinch deal because the Avalanche needed some offense and certainly got it. Point man for their power play to join Sackett. Along the boards, Nichols and Detmarsh were banging at it now. Adam Detmarsh skates in across the line. Detmarsh got it in back of the net. Scott Young is on it. Fighting for it. Smith will take it away for Chicago. As the Hawks skated out to center, Joe Murphy. His long shot. Patrick Waugh looking for it. Isn't sure where it is. It's under his pad as Terry Gregson gives him the whistle. So we'll get a faceoff coming up.
Patrick had absolutely no idea where that puck was on the long shot by Amonte. And you can watch him here. Here's the shot. Now, the reason he doesn't pick it up is it goes right by the defenseman's dark-colored socks. Sometimes it's very difficult for a goalie to pick it up. Look at him. Where is this puck anyway? I'd love to know where it is. And luckily for Patrick Watts, in front of him.
Tony Amonte, 30-goal plateau three times, and a teammate of Jeremy Roenick, high school in the Boston area.
And he said to me, I asked him, how do you play with Jeremy now? He said, all I have to do is get open. I said, what about when you were kids? He said, well, Jeremy used to just go from one end of the rink to the other, so then I just headed to the goal crease.
Picking up the garbage.
Exactly.
That Jeremy Roenick leaves him.
He says, I see the puck a little more now in the neutral zone, that Roenick's a little bit older and it's a little tougher for him.
Roenick backhands went off the board. Daze going after it. Adam Foote is there, leaves it. Gusarov is hit hard by Roenick. Chelios pitching in. Stefan Yell tied him up. And here's Ricci left wing side. Ricci faked the shot, will carry into the zone. Ricci is hit hard. Daze went down. Then hit on the play by Chelios was keen. Chicago. Daze goes to the front, as does Amonte. That shot in, and Patrick Waugh will hang on to that one. 16:39 to go in the second. It's still the Hawks by one. Steve Smith, who we saw in Stanley Cup engravings in the Calgary Flames' first round against Chicago. They were having so much trouble scoring. And a cartoon in one of the Calgary papers was asking, where's Steve Smith, who was hurt first round for Chicago? Shot at him for the one he put in his own goal, but the Flames needed some type of break. Well, that's the type of way it's been for Steve Smith. A great career, and you're remembered for the one
poke. Poor guy.
Yeah, I know.
Will they ever forget that or leave him alone on that play? I mean,
never.
He's been a great player, and he's had a great career, as you mentioned.
Faceoff coming up to the right of Patrick Waz. Brent Sutter's knocked out, so Jeff Shantz will come in to take this one against Dave Hanna. Shantz wins it. Brent Sutter turning away from Clem, got the shot away, the rebound in front. That's cleared away by Foote. Shantz got it to Sutter. Here's Probert working it in the corner. Bob Probert knocked down by Foote, who bucks with Sutter. Dave Hannon tying him up, and Clem is hit by Shantz. And Adam Foote will skate it free, and just flip one out to center ice. Chelio says, okay, we'll give it right back to you.
This is exactly what the Hawks want to do. Spend a lot of time in the Avalanche zone, cycling the puck down low.
Hawks possession, first period fairly even. LeFave took a hit from Shantz. Finally, though, Hannon. We'll clear it out to John Clem. Clem, a very intense player and a smart player. Free agent signing by Quebec. A defenseman, but is playing forward. At the point, the fade shot whistled wide. Forsberg couldn't control it as it comes back to center. Now Kaminsky. He's knocked off the puck by Chelios, who turns to get away from Forsberg. Then in turn lost the puck. Here's Kaminsky, right wing side. Drops one back for Forsberg. Lemieux goes to the front and scores! What a shot! Forsberg roofed it. This game's tied 1-1.
We've talked the whole series about Forsberg and how strong he is on his skates. And this is an excellent example of it here as we have him ISO'd all the way up the ice. And finally the Avalanche find room on top of Belfour. But look at how strong he is. He fends off the Hawk player and throws it right up on the roof. And that is some kind of goal. Uses his leg to protect the puck, drives and then just shovels it right up on the roof of Ed Belfour.
Isn't that just what Joe Sakic was talking about, how tough it is when you're in close? You have to make the perfect shot. We just saw it.
What a goal by Forsberg. I saw him in the hallway, and you couldn't not look at the guy's legs. I mean, they're like tree trunks, 100-year-old oak trees. I mean, they're just huge, and that's maybe one of the reasons why he has such terrific balance.
Tied for fourth in playoff scoring coming in was Forsberg. That is his 12th point. Forsberg from Kaminsky at 4:31. It's all tied up at one. In each game, Chicago has grabbed the lead, and then Colorado has come back to tie. Patrick Roy stops it, took away the icing, but did keep it away. Now Roenick almost stole the puck. Dazale slapped one back in as the Hawks clear the zone and now going after. Stolen there by Amonte. Centers the puck. Oh, Daze couldn't corral it. Comes to the point to Suter. Back of the goal, Amonte gets chased and skates away from Gusarov. Amonte leaves it for Roy. But he was too well tied up. And Foote was able to clear.
Coaches and players will tell you when you get scored against, you want to come back with a good shift. And that's what the Hawks have done on this last shift here by Amonte and Roenick and Daze.
Hit at center, put on Roenick by Gusarov as Joe Sakic speeding in, puts on the brakes. Wheeling one back, centered in front. That went off of Keane's skate. To the point it comes. Well, Lennon shot deflected in front. Forsberg had to be quick. Belfour was down and made the save.
Well, I mentioned they had a good shift, but they stayed out too long and they were outchanged. They got caught in their own zone and Belfour had to be very sharp on a shot that was redirected in front of him. Here's a look at it right here. Well, Lennon with the shot. There's the redirect. A nice tip in front. Belfour, you know he's going to cover the bottom half of the net. And the Avalanche, even when they're tipping the puck, if they can put a little more on it so it's up on the roof, they'll be more successful. And earlier on, Roenick and Lemieux get all tied up. And, well, hey!
Two sticks are better than one.
That's holding the stick, and I've lost my stick.
And now Claude Lemieux has it back, 30-year-old, who has 39 shots heading into play tonight, second to Joe Sakic's 44 to lead all playoff performers. That was a long shift as Kaminsky stayed out there a long time. Ricci tried to backhand one in. Smith stopped him at the line. Coney feathered a pass through, but it's picked off by Wolanin. His shot went wide of the net. Moving up was Krupp, now settles back in. And the back checking by Ricci prevented the Hawks from getting it in deep. But they will this time as Ciccone sends it in. Mixes it up with Stefan Yell. Sent back behind the net. Now the Avalanche have to give chase in their own zone. But Ricci will outlet. Here's Keane. In across the line. His shot high over top of the net. Belfour wants a stoppage in play and he'll get one as he scoots down and grab that puck. There's Peter Forsberg as we update the scoring leaders for you. See Joe Sakic, Peter Forsberg on his way up along with Kaminsky, tied for second place. What a day Steve Yzerman had yesterday to move right in there with 12 points.
Chris Chelios was not too happy on the last goal, and maybe this is why, right here. He gave the puck away in the neutral zone, and that resulted in the goal. You can see Chelios afterwards. He knows he made a mistake. You can bet that he'll be back to make up for it. That's the kind of competitor that Chris Chelios is.
And a seven-time All-Star. Back of the goal, Daze sent one behind the net, Suter on it. And up the boards. Long rink-wide pass for Daze, who has speed around Gusarov in front. And that was stopped by Patrick Roy. And a penalty coming up from Terry Gregson. The fans in behind thought he had it. Patrick Waugh made the save, and Terry Gregson has called a penalty.
That was an odd play. I mean, the importance for all you young players of driving a net. Dazey has terrific speed all of a sudden from one mark to the next, and he's worked on his skating, we mentioned the last show, all summer long. But look at this burst of speed. He uses his body again to protect the puck. Now somebody should be helping him out here and driving the net, because all of a sudden Waugh makes a save, and look at it just drops right in front of him. Where's Amonte? Where's Roenick? They have to drive the net because Dazey really set them up by making a great play by streaking down the boards, and now we have an Avalanche penalty as Gusarov is in the box for slashing, and that happened just after the net drive by Dazey.
Oh, the 31-year-old in the box, and the Blackhawks head to a power play, 1-for-2 on it tonight. As we look at the penalty to Alexei Gusarov.
Right here. Boom, right on the leg afterwards. And
well, again, seemed to get the stick and then the leg. And
well, nevertheless, an opportunity for the Hawks to get the lead in this hockey game.
So Jeremy Roenick against Stephan Yelle, and the Hawks control the faceoff. Suter takes it from Chelios and then gives it back to him in a return feed. Chelios at the right wing circle, looks for an open man. Feed across for Chelios was out of his reach, but Suter's able to hold that puck in. Side of the goal for Amonte. Digs it free, but couldn't get the shot away. Gaze on it. Roenick, one-time shot. That's blocked as Yell got in front. Roenick on it again. Looking for an opening. Gaze, the shot, and Patrick Waugh stopped that one. He got down with that right pad and was able to hold it out.
You can see what the Hawks are doing. They're using the high play, Chelios and Suter, but then they're waiting for everybody to shift forward, and then they have the low play open. And Roenick here with a terrific individual effort. He's going to walk right through the seam of the box and find Dazey right here. Boy, that's why Dazey scored 30 goals this season. He has a terrific release. And I mentioned the low play. Here's an example again. This happened in the first period, too. Amonte was open, but he just can't seem to find the handle down low on the pass from Suter from the point.
Right from the draw, Colorado's Hannon able to clear it down the ice. With a minute 12 left in this Avalanche penalty, the Hawks looking to take a 2-1 lead. Joe Murphy giving chase. Patrick Waugh out of the net to play it around the boards. Knocked down by Craven. Chelios pinching in, but coming over there was Nichols. He couldn't hold the puck in the zone. John Klemm forcing the Hawks back. Now Nichols will skate it out. That pass was too far. Popped over Murphy's stick, and this will be icing as Sylvain Lefebvre is back to touch it. Lefebvre in his seventh season, the 29-year-old. Played junior in Laval, signed as a free agent in Montreal in 86. A reminder, no building louder than this one if you want crowd noise.
That's for sure.
1-900-870-0022. 95 cents per call. Give us your thoughts on the Stanley Cup playoffs, your team, favorite player, player you dislike the most, and we may air your thoughts.
And not an empty seat in the house for this classic tonight.
No, we mentioned off the top that the Hawks set a new NHL record, averaging more than 20,000 fans per game in 41 home dates. Dazey streaking in from the right wing side, but the puck didn't get in deep, and if he touches it, it'll be offside, but he won't.
You know what that means? They'll match Jeremy Roenick's offer for sure, and they'll probably go after a few free agents as well. Look for them to grab a second ice centerman to support Roenick.
Yeah, it's going to cost Bill Wirtz to sign Roenick, but he has said in the papers here in Chicago they must have him, and they'll have to do whatever it takes to sign him.
I'll give you a couple of names. Maybe wait for Arnett for free agent signing.
Here's Roenick, left wing side. Nice move into the slot. Dazey! Just whistled by the outside of the net. Kelly will slot. Dazey. Oh, good save by Patrick Waugh. Rebound, Roenick. Penalty over. That shot blocked in front, and finally the Avalanche clear.
And Patrick Waugh is absolutely stoning Dazey the last few shifts.
Grew up enjoying watching Patrick Waugh. He's going to hate him by the time this one's over.
Is that the truth?
Give away, back of the goal in front. Oh, Patrick Waugh robbing Jeff's chance. at the side of the crease. What a stop that was to keep this game tied. Here's Kaminsky. Centering in front, Carney takes it before Lemieux can get there. That's Patrick Watt, his playoff best, as Forsberg was knocked to the ice by Probert, who elbowed him in game two in this series, but that one was a good hit. Sent in by Chicago, back of the net. Chance, who was stoned earlier, looks to center. He can't. Scott Young on it and flips it past Nichols to center.
And every time Probert's on the ice, the Avalanche players are looking over their shoulder.
Here's Nichols busting through into the slot, and Murphy couldn't drop one off as Craven would have been wide open. Bolanin takes a peek and just backhands one in. Ed Belfour, who loves to come out and play that puck, puts one on the near boards. Crowd with their Let's Go Hawks chant. Sent through center. Gusarov settles it. But Murphy takes it. Back for Kearney. That lead pass for Nichols, though, is offside at the Colorado line. We've seen some great goaltending. We're still tied, 1-1.
The way these goaltenders are playing, we may be here for a while tonight, Ken, because they have been absolutely outstanding. And Dazé with a good chance in the slot. Patrick Waugh reads it all the way and has his pad on it almost before the puck is there. And then a miscue here by the Avalanche defense sets up another big-time chance for the Hawks. Boy, did Patrick Waugh get across in a hurry on Jeff Shen.
That was Ozolinch, who slipped back of the net to give the Hawks that opportunity, but Patrick Waugh bailed him out. 9:20 to go, second period. Hawks and Avalanche tied 1-1. Patrick Waugh stops that, but it's offside at the line.
Just tell tonight that he's in a groove. Look at his eyes. Dazé is wondering what he is going to have to do as he shakes his head to beat Patrick Waugh.
Dazé had 30 goals, 53 points in his rookie year. 3 goals and 5 points in the playoffs to lead all rookies. Weinrich, cross ice for Steve Smith, who sends one in. Uwe Krupp couldn't clear that puck. Now he gets it back, stolen, Craven, point it goes. That shot high over top of the net by Weinrich. Joe Murphy back of the goal, gives it to Craven. Murphy has 2 game-winning goals so far in the playoffs. Craven looks back to the point. Smith, good job to deflect it. Now has to give chase as the Hawks control. Bernie Nichols turning as Colorado makes a change. Murphy in across the line, bumped by Detmarch as it's sent back into the Hawks zone. Ed Belfour leads it ahead. Here's Roenick. Amonte goes to the front of the net. Drop pass, Chelios. Rebound. Roenick was on his backhand and couldn't control. Here's Roenick back of the net. Circling in front. Passes off as Chelios had moved in. But it went right through his legs. Gusarov couldn't clear. Roenick got over. Now leaves it for Forsberg. Forsberg has the Colorado goal from Kaminsky here to tie up this game at 1. Suter opened the scoring on a power play in the first. Lemieux shot. That's high over top of the net. Puck along the near boards. Kaminsky, nice feed. Gets it through to Ozolinch. Return pass in front. And that opportunity just failed to click as Yale couldn't convert. And Ozolinch couldn't get over to hold it in, and he'll go after it. Swats Yale at center. Gets it ahead. Here's Ricci. His shot through. That's blocked. And the Hawks will clear. Will this deflect right to Patrick Waugh? It does to negate the ice. Lefebvre, quick outlet feed for Ricci. Chance was on him quickly. And just as fast, Yell was stopped in his tracks by Brent Sutter. Feed hopped over Keenstick. That hit Yell on the way into the zone. But some good back checking by Sutter took him out of the play. Then a hot giveaway. Here's Yell shooting. Belfour rebound. Scores! Mike Ricci! Oh, do the Avalanche need goals from him, and they got one. It's 2-1 Colorado.
Well, Ricci said to me this morning he was going to get one. And he certainly does here as he follows up the play because of a bad hawk giveaway right here. Yell ends up with the puck. Watch Ricci stick on the ice, hunting the loose puck. The Hawks defense have their back to the play, and he's able to find it right here and throw it past Ed Belfour.
Mike Ricci had just 6 goals in the regular season, playing in 62 games, through a sprained ankle, back injury, nasal surgery. Had so many opportunities, couldn't bury him. He does here for his 2nd playoff goal.
And he told me he was going to let me brag about the Peterborough Petes. Of course, he is a former Pete, but I won't do it tonight. So, there you go.
Well, there's a first for everything. He was the 4th overall pick from the Flyers in 90. The Scarborough native has given Colorado a 2-1 lead. Ricci from Yale at 12:53, the scoring play. Now the Hawks going after that puck. Sergei Krivokrasov out there along with Savard and Cummins. This line has seen limited ice time tonight. Krivokrasov with it. Played well though. Taking the spot of the injured Craven in game 2, or the sick Craven in game 2. The Hawks clear it ahead. That was too far. Patrick Waugh, seeing icing was going to be called, but that's taken away as Savard got in there. But now it's Reichel. He's bumped on the play. Moving in after it is Young. Got it in back of the goal. But Krivokrasov will feed it ahead. Stopped by Foot. That shot just deflected wide of Belfour. Banging at it was Cummins just to clear the zone. And no icing. Patrick Waugh will play it. All the way ahead to Joe Sackett. His feed sends in Adam Deadmarsh. Ed Marsh trying to work it free. He couldn't. The Hawks look to clear the zone, and finally they will get it out. But then Sakic picked the pocket of Craven, who now goes after it. Turning it up the boards to safety, and Lefebvre will send it right back.
Well, this must be a frustrating period for the Hawks. They've had a lot of good chances on Waugh, but they've shot themselves in the foot with 2 bad giveaways that have resulted in Avalanche goals.
Here's Bernie Nichols. He couldn't get the puck deep. But capitalizes the game as the puck hit him. His group couldn't clear. Chelios the shot. Patrick Waugh sees that one through a crowd. 5:19 to go, 2nd period, 2-1 Colorado.
Closed captioning of tonight's game is provided by RE/MAX, Canada's leading real estate organization.
I talked about before the break that the Hawks are shooting themselves in the foot. Here's the giveaway right here by Ciccone, right through the middle. And that results in the goal by the Avalanche as Ricci bats the rebound pass at Belfour.
And that is Nick Colorado to a 2-1 lead. Smith, back of the net, icing called. Right now, let's check in with Steve Armitage. Steve?
Thank you, Ken. The last time the Hawks won the Stanley Cup was way back in 1961. This man, Stan Mikita, had a huge role in that victory. Stan, does it seem like 35 years ago that you were sipping champagne from a cup?
Yes, it does, Steve. It really does. It was a long, long time ago. Although we had a reunion about a month ago, and it was real nice to see the fellas again.
Can you make any comparisons between this team and the one in 61?
Well, nobody really picked us to win the cup in that year, and I don't think too many people picked the Blackhawks of this year to do it. And they have a pretty good chance. I think the goaltending is the big key. Belfour's done a great job for him, and I think if it wasn't for Glenn Hall in our day, we wouldn't have won it.
Stan, thanks for doing this. Guys?
Well, when I played in Chicago, I had the pleasure of getting to know Stan Mikita, and I'll tell you what, he's one of the classiest men that I've ever met in hockey.
You bet he is. I had the opportunity to play with him at some fantasy camps. An outstanding individual. That puck's knocked down with a high stick. 4:36 to go in the second. We're back in a moment. Well, tomorrow night, 7:30 Eastern, the scene shifts to Miami for game 3 of the Eastern Conference semifinal with the Flyers and Panthers tied at a game apiece. 4:30 Pacific time. Do you think we have this game covered?
How many are there? Why, we're able to give you that terrific ISO on Forsberg when he scored his goal.
Great technical crew here.
And we must say the truck did a pretty good job at it as well.
Nice move in there by Lemieux, doing a good job, but Roenick got over. Sent one out, nice play by Forsberg behind his back to hold it in. Kamensky shooting, and that was blocked in front. Hit Chelios on the way through. And the Hawks clear, but another glaring Hawk mistake. Gusarov. Couldn't get it through into the Hawk zone as Chelios blocked it. Now they'll send one in. as Forsberg heads to the bench. Hornick pumped by Kaminsky. Kucherov held it in. Here's Kaminsky, stopped in his tracks by Rona. Carney around. Amonte knocks that puck down. Off the glass, and it will go the length of the ice. So Colorado with some pressure, forcing another Hawk icing. The faceoff coming back 200 feet. Right from the faceoff, the Hawks control. Weinrich got it ahead, chance, touches Alberta, couldn't break free, then Keane. He bumps along with Brent Sutter. Sylvain Lefebvre to the backhand and gets one into the Hawks zone just as quickly. Chicago clears and Sandis Ozolinch turns with it. Sees the ice so well, does Ozolinch. To his defense partner Lefebvre, who is keen with him because Ozolinch takes so many chances. Ricci was knocked down at the Hawk line and was offside as Colorado shot it in.
Well, I mentioned during this second period that Bob Probert has been a real force for the Hawks. And he's been hitting everybody, doing it in a clean fashion, but certainly you can tell the Avalanche players are very aware when he has been on the ice.
Wouldn't anyone be?
There's an example of a little hit there, but comes up with big with a better one here. Well, he just doesn't quite catch them this shift, but he's been catching them a lot. So far in this second period, he gives Yell an extra little poke there.
Robert's goal was to score 20 goals this season. Finished with 19, and oh, how he tried to get the number 20. And he had his chances. Joe Murphy skating away for Chicago. He had 22 on the season. But has always been a big playoff performer. Here's Sackett. Too young, that shot. As Belfour had it, it was going wide, but decides to hang on, so a faceoff coming up to his left. Coming up after 40 minutes, Ron McLean will be guesting with Curtis Joseph, who was just so outstanding overseas for Team Canada.
And I'd like to echo Don Cherry's thoughts during Coach's Corner. Curtis Joseph is a good guy who really cares about Canada, and he played just a terrific series in the World Championships, and we'll have him live in the atrium.
Well, that's coming up 2:35 from now. That's how much is left in the second period, with Colorado leading Chicago 2-1. Peter Forsberg is seeing a lot of Brent Sutter tonight, but it's Forsberg who has the go-ahead goal. Smith gets his elbow up high, and a penalty coming up. As you were talking about Probert, and he came in and got the elbow up to finish off the hit, and he's going to the penalty box. That for charging.
I just mentioned that he's been hitting.
Well, he didn't get the hard ones before like you
well,
were talking
hard,
about.
But
now he
cleanly,
gets one.
But this one here, well, he goes after Lemieux and takes a few strides. It doesn't glide a whole lot, and maybe that's why he's in the box for charging. Lemieux with some good discipline as well, and that's been the story of the series so far, and you can tell right here that Probert knows that he just took a bad penalty.
Sure, and Craig Hartsburg knows that too, as he was preaching that to his team, but we saw it so much in the Colorado win in game number two. They were turning the other cheek.
And the reason why it is such a bad penalty for sure is the time of the game. It's just over 2 minutes left in the second period. The Avalanche are up by one. If they ever score here, the Hawks will be in trouble going into the third period.
And it's sent down the ice right from the faceoff, so the Avalanche will start out of their own zone. Colorado 0 for 2 with the man advantage. And they bring it in across the line. Forsberg. Nice move to get away from the checking of Carney. Back to the point. Sackett shot just went wide and Chelios clears. I mentioned during the regular season that Colorado had lost just once, but leading after two, that to Chicago. Of course, they were leading in game one and lost and have a lead now against the Hawks. Rink wide pass for Kaminsky in the slot. He couldn't handle a bouncing puck. And Roenick slows up, takes a look, and Colorado will start with it again. Joe Sackett, Roenick on him, gets it ahead to Ricci. Seeing a lot of ice time. Past two games for Mark Crawford. More confidence into the slot. Sackett scores! Sakic has given Colorado a 3-1 lead on a power play.
Joe Sakic starts this playoff in the neutral zone with an unbelievable backhand pass. Right here, stick to stick. Not many players can make that pass through traffic in the National Hockey League. And then he finds the seam in the slot. Good play by the Avalanche to work it down low. Now Sakic right now is just trying to sneak in through the seam, and another good backhand pass. And boy, Sakic, he has one of the best releases in the National Hockey League. He doesn't take any time at all of tailing on a stick, off a stick, but he got a break as well as that pass from Lemieux hit a Chicago Blackhawk foot and then ended up right on his stick in the slot.
He's the leader, playoff goals with 10 now. Had the lead coming into play tonight. Lemieux and Ricci picking up the assist at 18:37 as we'll get another chance to see Joe Sakic score.
Watch the Hawks here. They're all chasing Lemieux and it hits a foot right here, a stick actually, Carney's stick, and it goes right on Sakic's stick. He makes no mistake, and that's a tough play for Ed Belfour as well, because all of a sudden Sakic appears right in front of him, and the puck is off his stick before you're even set.
Joe Sakic, only 12 playoff games prior to this season. First time in the second round back in 87, he was a junior when Quebec got to round two versus Montreal.
Not a junior anymore.
Sakic now with a six-game goal streak. 8 goals in that span. He has been awesome. Chicago putting out their check line against Forsberg. It was a power play goal, but Sakic gives him a little bit more room out there. Avalanche trying to pin it into the Chicago zone with less than a minute to go here in the second period. And a 2-goal lead. Backboard is Krupp. Up the boards, that's knocked down by Murphy with a chance. Shooting, scores! Murphy!
Murphy and the Hawks with 36 seconds to go in the second period puts them back in the hockey game. And how about this shot? Craven's right in front of Waugh, and he's in the crease. And that's why maybe Ricci is a little bit upset with the official on this play, but Murphy with a perfect shot right up on the roof at Patrick Waugh. And you can see right here that Craven is definitely in front of Waugh, and he's definitely in the crease. Nevertheless, this puck will count, and Joe Murphy gets his fifth goal this playoff campaign.
Well, Joe Murphy likes to call himself a big game player, and what a big goal that is to get Chicago back into it. He is the Hawks goal leader. Postseason is Murphy with 5. So quickly, Chicago counters the power play goal from Sakic. They are within 1 a game. Dead Marsh to Sakic. Beating ahead for Young, leaving it for Dead Marsh, but that was read perfectly and taken away. Chelios gets it ahead, a Monte shot. That was stopped by Patrick Waugh. So the second period comes to a close with the Avalanche going to the dressing room with a 3-2 lead on the Chicago Blackhawks.
Hockey Night in Canada on CBC presents After 40 Minutes.
...1923 of the second period, Joe Murphy scores, but watch 32, Murray Craven obviously in the crease in front of Patrick Roy, affecting a bit of a screen, and Patrick at the end of the period went over to Terry Gregson to make his case, but it's too late for that, of course, and that's a huge goal for the Blackhawks that cuts the deficit to 3-2 after two periods. Roy and the Avalanche a little upset. Well, Curtis Joseph has donned Don Cherry's attire to join us here in the second intermission. Congratulations on the silver medal, Curtis. Can't say how proud we were of you and the team, and especially your year starting in Vegas and all, but let's get right to it. What's it like to be in a shootout at a world championship?
Well, it's a little nerve-wracking. You know, you don't face them every day, but obviously it's exciting, and when you win, it's a good way to win. But if you lose in a shootout, you say, you know, it's a tough way to lose. But it was exciting.
How about representing your country?
Well, it's the first time I've donned the Canadian jersey, and that's one of the reasons I went over there in the first place, was to put on that Canadian jersey. And I tell you, it was an incredible feeling just putting it on and playing for your country. It was just a tremendous feeling.
Well, let's look at some of the highlights of Friday when you beat Russia to move into the gold medal game. You're down 1-0. Berzan had scored to put them ahead. It's five shooters, of course, and now the second is Alexei Yashin. What were you thinking?
Well, I know obviously he's a great player, and he just kind of came in, and it looked like he was going to shoot, and he tried to go five hole, and he just tried to close it up.
What's the process? Did you have any idea of who the five shooters would be, and did you get tips from the bench?
Actually, I just ran to the bench real quickly and just tried to go over their lineup real quick, guys who had played with them in the NHL, and what does Yashin like to do, or, you know, you just try and get as many tips as you can and try and sort it out as they're coming in.
Steve Duchesne would, of course, know him. What did he say? Did he have any tips?
He said high glove or five hole, and he was pretty accurate.
Now, Nikolishin from Hartford's next. What did you know about him?
Actually, I didn't know too much, but I knew he had good hands and he's a very skilled player.
And what did the guys on the bench? Apparently they figured it out at the last second,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, right about at this time, they're yelling from the bench, backhand, forehand. And obviously I didn't hear him, but it was a late tip and it didn't get to me, but fortunately it didn't go in.
And now, as we saw when you got up there, you tweaked the right knee. We were all scared to death because that's what you heard at the end of the year in Edmonton.
Yeah, I had pulled my MCL a little bit, and on that particular play, it strained it a little bit, but at the heat of the moment, you don't even feel it after about 5 seconds.
I bet you not many people know Guy Hebert, who's been brilliant in the league now for a couple of years, patterns himself after you because he watched you play all those years, and now you get two Anaheim Mighty Ducks. If they had any smarts, they'd have got on the phone to Guy to get some tips. But here we go with the next is Roman Aksyuta. What are you thinking here? Big guy.
Well, I know he's got a great shot, and he usually shoots it low, but he tried to go high and just try to get my body in front of it, but he does have a great shot.
Now, Valery Karpov, this is the save that sets up the victory. We don't get a lot of look at this, but tell us about Karpov.
Well, I didn't know anything about him, actually, and he just kind of came in and was trying to take away the five-hole and glove. That's two of the favorite spots for the shooters, and he kind of tried to outweight me, and he went up high and just got a glove on it and was fortunate.
And here's Yannick. What about this goal?
Yannick, he did this play to me the first couple days, top glove, and I looked just like that. he gives a little fake five-hole, and then he kind of scoops it up and goes top corner. It's a great move.
Don't know if you can explain on camera here. Look at their reaction. What guys must have been petrified to be in that position to go in a shootout. What was Travis Green, some of the guys, thinking?
Well, some of the guys said once they got over the puck and they started skating in, they felt their knees wobble a little bit, and they weren't sure they were going to make it to the net, but they did, and everybody said it was a scary feeling.
Maybe two thoughts, maybe a highlight of the trip. What, if you had to pinpoint one, of course that shootout victory's got to be it, but just in terms of togetherness with some NHLers and the coaching staff, what stands out?
Well, the coaching staff had put a great plan together. We tried to keep a third man high the whole time, and we got away from it in a few of the games early, and we were unsuccessful, but when we stuck to the game plan and everybody played together as a unit, we seemed to come together, and we didn't do that well in the preliminary round, but we came through when we had to, and it was just unfortunate. It was a game of inches, and we just lost by that much.
When you started the year in Vegas, did you ever dream that you'd end up back in the league? And you probably wished you were in the playoffs with Edmonton because you had a nice club there, but to have it end this way has got to be sweet after all you were through.
You're right. It was a tough year, and there's no doubt about that, but that's one of the reasons I went over there. It's hard to end on not making the playoffs, and so we went over there and ended on a good note. I think I'm going to have a good summer now.
Good things happen to good people. Curtis, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Silver medal for Team Canada, backstopped by Curtis in goal. We'll continue with our Stanley Cup story, too, on Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC. Joel Sakic has his 10th of the Stanley Cup playoffs, a power play goal. Joe Murphy with that controversial tally late, 3-2 after two periods of play. Mike Ricci has had a big night, his second goal of the playoffs and one assist. We'll have to check on the Peterborough Petes versus Guelph Storm score and many more other hockey stories as we continue on Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC. Three of the game, very physical. Penguins have won 4 out of 5 playoff games at Madison Square Garden dating back to 1989. They got their work cut out clearly in game 3. In New York. Philadelphia Flyers will be in Miami, and we'll see more of Eric Lindros hitting Brian Skruland and everyone else in sight. In fact, Joe Manofsky has done a great job along with Rhett Warner checking And it looks like Gord Murphy will join the brigade on the blue line. He is back from a broken toe. Kevin Holler's got the pins out of his hand, but he's still not able to go for Philadelphia. Flyers in Florida, 7:30 ET, and we'll have that one for you tomorrow on Molson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
I hate to give up a goal in the final minute of the period, but the good news is you still have a one-goal lead.
Yeah, that's important for us. I thought we had an excellent period, a breakdown at the end, but we've got the third period now. We just have to play solid defensively and make smart decisions at the two blue lines.
Tell me about your 10th goal of the playoffs.
Well, Claude Lemieux made a great pass to me, and I think Ricci tipped it right to me. It was right on my stick, and I just shot it as quick as possible.
Roenick's been over you all night, but I guess that goes with the territory when you're the leading goal scorer in the playoffs.
Yeah, we've had our battles, and it's great competition. I think they're playing really well as a team. Defensively, they don't give any of us a lot of space out there, and we just have to work and keep working at it.
Joe, good luck in the third.
All right, thanks a lot.
As the third period is underway, and Sakic's 10 goals, one shy of the franchise record for most goals in a playoff season, 11 set by Michel Goulet back in 1985. Avalanche roll one into the Hawk zone.
Michel Goulet is here tonight. He makes his home in Chicago still and works for the Avalanche.
Here's Chelios. Hawks to our right. The Avalanche, Patrick Roy to our left. Patrick Roy left at the end of that second period, irate, feeling that Craven was in the crease on the Murphy goal that has brought Chicago within one.
Well, he was in the crease.
Yes, he was. Stefan Yell in back of Ed Belfour. Tarney seals him out of the play, and Chelios turns.
The big question is, was Terry Gregson blocked on that play somehow so he really did not see the goal develop? And that happens to officials sometimes, and many think maybe that's why there should be two referees now in the National Hockey League officiating instead of one.
Patrick Waugh stopped it back of the net, rolled up the near boards. Mike Keane, his cross-ice pass. That's flipped into the corner by Mike Ricci, who's had himself a big night. Goal and an assist, and three assists in game two. So Mike Ricci is on quite a roll. Here's Jeremy Roenick. Has to go get his pass. It was behind Amonte. Now he gets it to him. Amonte into the slot. That was blocked by Denmark. Kucherov rolls Roenick down to the ice. And Scott Young, he looked rink wide, but that was knocked down neatly by Amonte. Suter off the boards and back into the Avalanche zone again. Quickly up to Scott Young, who just missed a hit from Amonte, who's been a real force for Chicago here in these playoffs. Detmarsh one-on-one against Weinrich, who just wouldn't let him go. Detmarsh again, slot to Klim, and it just knocked off his stick. And a fine defensive play there by Bernie Nichols. Amonte looks to clear it, and he does. Joe Murphy giving chase. Patrick Roy beats him to it around for Craig Willanet, who lets it go, and the Avalanche able to clear. Chelios, the Chicago native, around to Smith, who takes the return feed. Craven going after it, as is Uwe Krupp. This will be icing if Krupp gets there first, and he does. And the faceoff will come back into the Chicago zone. And the Blackhawks, as they've done in the previous two games, open the scoring. The only goal of the first period, a power play marker. They're 1-for-3 on it tonight. Then in the second period, back came the Avalanche, and they are also 1-for-3 on the power play. Sakic taking them to a 3-1 lead before Joe Murphy's fifth cut it to 3-2 late in that second period.
A lot of players sometimes do not get a lot of recognition. Eric Weinrich is one of them, but watch the play he makes right here on Detmarsh. It's a one-on-one. Detmarsh has him in the inside, but he ties up his stick in his arms with his own stick and then pushes Weinrich off the puck. A smart veteran play.
Adam Detmarsh, a second cousin of Butch Detmarsh, played in the NHL in the 70s. Adam Detmarsh will turn 21 on Friday. He's a Trail BC native, but will play for the U.S. in the World Cup because his mother is a U.S. citizen. What a great hockey player he's going to be. What speed he has and good hands. Off the draw, Smith back of the goal for Chris Chelios. Lemieux quickly on him, but Chelios got it ahead to Sutter, now to Bob Probert. Probert shot, Patrick Roy saw that all the way, and he'll hang on. So another faceoff coming up.
The Hawks will be a very patient team this third period to get the one goal they need to tie it up. That's because they're a veteran team, and they've been in this situation many times. Craig Hertzberg knows that he does not want to open it up at all against this Avalanche team, because once they do, they
can't afford to handle the skill level that the Avalanche have offensively. So they will just wait it out, try and keep the puck on the sideboards, continue to clog up the neutral zone, and wait for a break.
Brent Sutter lining up for this face-off against Dave Hannon. The Avalanche and the Hawks control. Chelios point, his shot, Patrick Roy made the save. It got through and now Lemieux's away. Lemieux crossing with Forsberg, gives him the puck. Now to Lemieux, quick shot, Belfour got over to stop that. Lemieux hits Smith back of the goal. Chelios sees Kaminsky coming at him and he finishes the check. And then Lemieux took a run at Chance, or Forsberg rather. Probert trying to work through. Puck loose in the slot as Chance ran into Probert and he went down. He was hit hard by his own player. The Hawks clear it in and want to change, but they clear it up into the seats. A stoppage in play with 16:46 to go in the third. Colorado by one.
Look at Forsberg, who has scored a big goal again this evening and been a force physically all over the ice. That's the trouble when you play the Avalanche. There's a fine margin of error because you may not give them many chances, but when you do, normally it ends up right in your net. And that's what's happened to the Hawks this evening. Gave up the puck twice on bad giveaways, and it was in their net twice afterwards.
Shots are only 18-16, favoring Chicago. It's the Avalanche, who lead by one. Denny Savard put on the body, and now with a break, Savard, and a goal! And Patrick Roy, rebound! Oh! Patrick Roy, two games in a row, robs Riva Krasov. Almost an instant replay from game two. This game still 3-2 Colorado, and give thanks to Waugh. Here's Detmarsh to Young, his shot, Belfour makes the save. Kucherov off the shot, that whistled wide of the net as the puck comes back into the Colorado zone. Waugh will leave it, 4 foot. Up to Scott Young, his pass picked off at center. Hook right in front of Terry Gregson, that from Ricci on Roenick. He overlooked that. Ricci circles the goal, centers in front. Belfour got that stick down to the deflect. Chelios fights off a hit and gives it to Carney. Quick feed for Tony Amonte up with Gaza. Amonte has it knocked off his stick, persists on the puck, gets it to the point, shot in front, hit Yell. Yell almost lost it as Gaza was back checking, but the Hawks still control. 3-2. Colorado leading Chicago. Here's Amonte. His shot, and Patrick Roy saw that all the way, and he'll hang on.
The book on Patrick Roy is he really plants his feet. So as a forward, what you try to do is delay your shot and change the angle on him. And that's exactly what Denis Savard does on this last play. Watch the delay right here. He's trying to move Patrick Roy, and what it does do is enable Waugh to give up a pretty big rebound, and look at this second effort by Waugh as he absolutely robs Kriva Krasov. But it's the delay that sets up the rebound. He has Patrick Waugh moving a little bit. Waugh can't find the puck, but oh, what a second effort as he robs Kriva Krasov.
Denny Savard needs just 3 playoff goals for 63 as a Hawk to pass Bobby Hull into first place. Doesn't see a lot of ice time though. Savard hitting, he may retire at the end of this season. His contract's up. Here's Brent Sutter. Had it poked off his stick and the Avalanche able to clear. Forsberg giving chase. Belfour will come out and leave it for Chelios. Forsberg, Lemieux, and Kaminsky up front for Colorado. Sutter into the left wing corner. It goes where Probert and Ozilinch go after it. But Patrick Roy knocked it by the two of them. Claude Lemieux can't clear it out. Comes to Probert. His shot. Patrick Roy stood his ground. Probert looking to get it back. Good work. Loose in the slot, Probert shooting, and Patrick Roy got that right pad down to stop it. Now Forsberg will clear. Ahead to Kaminsky. His shot fell for easy save, looks for a man to give it to as the Avalanche change. Smith sends a soft one to the Colorado line, will land him. His cross-ice pass to Krupp. Moving it in for Detmarsh. Adam Detmarsh. A seal to the end boards by Weinrich, and turning with it is Smith. Away from Young. Got it out. Murphy couldn't get anywhere. But trailing the play is Nichols. He took a bit of a stick. Detmarsh continues on, though. Young goes for the net. Pass to him, just out of his reach. Scott Young still on. Has it come back to him. That shot through the crease. Bolanin moves up. Joe Murphy lets that puck go. And that will allow Craven to move it into the Colorado zone. He goes after it as the Hawks change and Krug turns. Sends it to his own bench. A dangerous play on the change. Almost too many men on the ice. Here's Sakic. He's over the boards. That shot. That hits Suter and deflected wide. Roenick just chops at it. Kaze kicks at it. And Craven gives chase, but Sakic on the back check stops him. What a nice feed ahead. Here's Roenick, and on goal scores! Roenick! Tie game!
You won't see him any prettier than this. Roenick has the ability to really pick up speed when he receives the puck and make great moves at a high tempo. And he totally fools Patrick Waugh on this play. But it all starts long before this. If you have another look at it right here, boy, look at how much room he ends up with. But don't forget, folks, he's doing that at a high tempo. Not many players in the league can do that. But it all starts way behind the play as Dazé makes a great play on the boards to kick the puck out to find Roenick later on the rush.
This place is going crazy. Dazé and Roenick set up the Hawks' opening goal by Suter. And now Dazé sets up Roenick now at 6:48 to tie up this game. Here's Kaminsky into the zone. He's knocked down. Lemieux on it. Forsberg looking for it to come loose. Kearney around the boards, but Ozil in shooting position. Gets one through, but Belfour there to hang on. 12:45 to go, third period. This game's all even. Hawks tied up the game, and now Keith Kearney in the box for slashing an Avalanche power play.
Well, most people remember the terrific move by Roenick to score this last Hawk goal, but the battles on the boards is what set it up. Dazé right here with a good kick into the neutral zone, and then Murray Craven once again with a terrific battle on Joe Sakic sets up Roenick, and then Roenick finishes it off, but it all starts with some good hard grit work on the boards.
And they're all chatting in front of the net now, and this has the crowd up in arms. Of course, Claude Lemieux in the middle of it. They haven't even dropped the puck yet to start this Colorado power play. Things have settled down now. Belfour talking it up. So Dazé and Craven getting the assists on the Roenick goal. Jeremy Roenick, who already had an assist tonight, is a point every game these playoffs. Smith ties up his man, and Chicago will clear. Ozolin, key man on this Colorado power play, along with Sakic on the point. Gives it to Ozolin. He can't bust through, though. So now Sakic will try. Fired in. Kaminsky knocked back to the point. Sakic there. His shot through, deflected. That didn't miss by much. On it quickly, though, is Smith off the glass and down. Knocked away by Amonte on the good forecheck.
And that cycling pressure that we've seen so often this series by the Hawks down ice when they're penalty killing.
Here's Sakic. Round back of the net, Ozolin moving in from his left point position, but overskated the puck, and again, the Hawks clear.
Watch the Hawks here. The first player will angle it to the boards. The second one will come in and cycle it where the puck goes. Ah, now they're not going to do it.
45 seconds left in this Colorado power play. Ricci, he was hauled down, no call, and again, Chicago clears. Husserov has Young to his left. Detmarsh up on the left wing side too. Husserov goes that way. That went off the skate in the game.
And there was a cycle that time, Ken.
And it didn't work. Sent through for Ricci. He went down. Smith fights off his check. Chelios is there. There you see the time left as the Hawks will pull off the rest of this Avalanche power play.
And you can hear the fans because this is a huge momentum builder for the Hawks to kill this penalty off.
Here's Sergei Krivokrasov. And to him, Patrick Waugh looked like a wall in the last two games. Krivokrasov was scoreless in 10 playoff games last year. That puck sent through to Belfour. And he will hang on. Well, throughout this series, we're talking about Claude Lemieux and Chris Chelios, how they're always at one another. Of course, Claude Lemieux and Chris Chelios were teammates in Montreal, and here are Chris's thoughts.
He ain't my close friend anymore right now for the next 2 weeks, but, you know, Claude, I know Claude, I know his game. I'm not going to let him intimidate me, and hopefully I can and break him before he tries to break me. And the thing is, we play against each other every shift. Tonight we're going to be against each other every shift again, and I'm going to try and drive him crazy. He's an emotional guy. It's easy to get under his skin, just like he tries to do to other people, and if you can shut him down, he's going to get frustrated.
Well, one of the reasons that Chris Chelios knows Lemieux so well, of course, they played together, but their children are even born on the same dates, and they're good friends off the ice.
Yes, certainly not tonight. Belfour can't find it. That shot got through, but lucky for him, it bounced out the other side. Daze clears, and it was a nice blind pass to Amonte. His shot was blocked. Lefebvre off the boards and up into the seats, so a stoppage in play with 10-10 to go, third period. Well, face-off from the right of Patrick Waugh. Back of the goal, Ricci around for Stefan Yell. Bernie Nichols quickly getting over there to cancel him out of the play. Perfect. Backhands one through. That's knocked down, though, by Wolanin. It goes through to Keane. Mike Keane the shot. Belfour got a piece of that to deflected wide.
Barely.
Yeah, around back for Murphy. And tipped out to center. Keane on it. He'll send Chicago back again. This has been a terrific line for the Avalanche. Keane along with Ricci and Stefan Yell, the rookie who has the puck now. Kept it in, but now Craven takes over. To Joe Murphy. Yell just feather one back into the Avalanche zone as both teams make changes. Chicago also a change. Ozeling. Pass just out of Kaminsky's reach. Belfour out to play it around the boards. At the line, but held in. Chicago looks to get it out, but can't. Probert couldn't get it past the stick of Kaminsky. Forsberg knocked it down and has the puck come back to him. Kaminsky dumped in front. Forsberg checked by Carney. Puck comes loose. Nice play by Ozeling to move up. But Chicago able to clear. Fave around the boards. Lemieux just knocked Probert out of the way as the puck rolls into Chicago territory as Forsberg mixed it up with Kearney. Fans wanted a penalty there. Puck loose at center for Chance.
And let's not forget Gregson may owe the Hawks one because he penalized the Hawks earlier in this third period, so let's watch for that.
Here's Lemieux into the left wing corner as he heads to the bench. Around it comes for Smith through his skates at the line. Good shot. That went wide. Sakic on it. In front of the net is Young. Sakic looking for him. Couldn't get it to him. Roenick. His rink wide feed. A good one to Amonte. Amonte. Taken out of the play. Then shoved to the ice by Foot. He's hurt. Terry Gregson right there. No call. But now is blowing the whistle, although they didn't hear it. As Tony Amonte writhing in pain, grabbing that right knee. Terry Gregson, no call. And now Roenick wants a little payback here.
Looks like Amonte's knee as he was pushed down. He is in considerable pain.
Now Terry Gregson was there and at that point had signaled no penalty. With 8:06 to go, as Bob Probert looks on, he'll be out there soon, we're sure. 3-3, Hawks and Avalanche. Well, there's Tony Amonte, one of four Americans who topped the Blackhawks scoring, and Craig Hartsburg can't afford to lose him and his speed, but he is hurt after being taken out by Foot.
Look at, he got all tangled up with Foot, and I want you to watch his leg, his right leg right here after he falls down or on the way down. He gets it caught on the boards.
And the stick.
And then there it goes right there. Oh, that's an ugly shot, and you have to think that it's his knee that is the problem. And of course, Roenick, right away, goes after Foot. And you have to admire Jeremy Roenick for doing that. And Daze is next in line as well.
Well, Tony Amonte, a third-round pick of the Rangers. By 93-94, playing for Mike Keenan, he said he had stripped him of all his confidence, had nothing left, and comes here and has played so, so well for the Chicago Blackhawks.
And that is a shame. He's had a great year, and I'll be very surprised if he's back again this year the way he went down. But you could see his foot sort of get caught up on the sideboards and drag behind him, and then foot gave him the shove, and he just went down in an awkward position. Looks like he obviously hurt his knee.
Roenick still seething about it. Monte had the lone goal for Chicago in game number two. Jeremy Roenick has tied up this game, and Bob Probert look for payback. Well, playoff time, you can't be stupid.
No, that's right.
The thing. Wait for your opportunity and make it clean. The Hawks preaching
discipline. It was more the position of the foot than anything else that Amonte got himself into.
And the fans were screaming because they wanted a holding penalty on the way down. And there's been a lot of talk. Craig Hartsburg's team and Bill Wirtz coming out in the papers and cutting up the officials prior to even the Calgary series. And we've seen more of it here with the call last game. So add some more fuel to their fire. So 3-3 with 7:50 to go, third period. Here's Probert. Dropping one back for Schantz. Jeff Schantz taken out of the play. Ozelinch around the boards it goes for Kaminsky. And he'll just backhand one to safety.
I said the position of the foot, that was Amonte's foot, not Adam's foot.
I got it. Bob Probert drops one to Schantz, in for Sutter, bouncing puck. Gets it to the point though, Carney's shot. Hit a leg in front and deflects to the corner. Schantz on it. Forsberg picked off that. But can't clear. Chelios then hit Forsberg with his pass around the boards. And out comes Claude Lemieux. One-on-one with Kearney. Belfour way out to make the save. And he'll leave it for Chelios. As he and Lemieux meet back of the net. Lemieux just finishes his check. Nothing wrong with that one. But the fans don't like it. Chelios to Nichols. He's bumped at center ice by Scott Young. That hit a partition, went to Sakic, but offside at the line, and we've talked about this last game in Denver.
You know, a brand new building, and I can't believe, as beautiful as this United Center is, that they put the stanchions up on the glass instead of going with the new glass like the Avalanche did. A good example of it there is Chelios threw one off the glass. Boy, that almost ended up right in the slot. Sakic was almost gone.
Joe Sakic in his eighth year in the league. These playoffs has a six-game goal streak now. Eight goals over that time. The league leader in shots into the third period in this game with 46 in the playoffs.
Both coaches now, as we look at them, are very conscious of who they have on the ice with just over 6 minutes to go in this third period. Their matchups, who's on defense, and a lot of bench management goes on more and more in the third period.
Game one of this series, of course, went to overtime. Jeremy Roenick getting the winner. Game three of this series tied at three with 6:30 to play in the third. At center ice. Taken by Detmarsh, trying to bust around Weinrich. Puts him to the ice. Detmarsh with it, back to the point. Krug, good job to hold it in with his skate after taking that deflection. Now the Avalanche will fire one back in and decide to make a complete change. Lots of room for the Hawks to carry out. Craven, he'll send one through. As Mike Keane will lead the rush. Gets it to Stefan Yell. Yell across the line around Roenick. His shot, easy blocker save, wide by Belfour. Smith, Yell lost his stick, knocked it down. Smith tying him up, then Kearney seals Ricci against the boards. Puck comes loose to Roenick. Around the net for Kriva Krasov. Foot pinching in to stop him in his tracks. Steve Smith, the veteran, wants to settle it down. Roenick gives it back to him, head up. Feed to Kriva Krasov, neatly to Roenick. Nice move to pick that up off his skate. Then Roenick knocked down to the ice by Foot, no call. Again, the fans want one. Took him out of the play. Kane takes the pass from Gusarov. Kane got the shot through, deflected in front. Weinrich there to knock it away. Trailing the play, Forsberg. What a move by Forsberg into the slot. That shot over top of the goal by Oselin. Oh, can Forsberg do some amazing things with that hockey stick? Here's Oselich with room. Penalty coming up. This will draw a standing ovation from the 20,000 plus here at the United Center.
Well, Ken, you just got the feeling that sooner or later this was going to happen. And the Hawks will be on the power play. We come back.
Well, with 4:49 to play, Alexei Gusarov in the box for hooking as Chicago goes to the power play.
Right here on Kriva Krasov, who has taken a Monty spot with Jeremy Roenick. Maybe takes a little extra dive, but nevertheless, Hawks now have a big power play chance.
They've almost called it interference, too. So Chicago, seven power play goals in the playoffs, one for three tonight, 10-1 in. Foot off the glass, but controlled by Nichols. Chelios and Suter at the points. Back of the goal it goes, Craven. Chelios getting over there, Stefaniel fighting off his check. Suter to Chelios. Back to Suter, couldn't control the puck. Hawks all standing over at their bench. Suter with it, will wire one in around the boards. Sylvain Lefebvre, first man on it though. Lefebvre to Foote. He'll get it to the line, and with some help from Dave Hannon, will clear it back to the Chicago blue line. 3-3, 3:50 to go, third period. The Hawks and Avalanche. Here's Roenick, who tied up the game in this third period. Denny Savard out there as well. Chelios keeps it in, into the slot. Savard shooting, and that went wide and a flex up into the seats.
Well, that puck was skating away from Denis Savard. He didn't get as much on it as he would have liked, but a terrific play by Chris Chelios to anticipate and pinch down to keep the puck in. And that leads the setup. Savard, watch this puck, though. It's just chasing away on him, and he can't get all of it, and it hits a stick and goes wide. But before that, Chris Chelios with a perfect pinch down the sideboards to keep the puck in to set up the play. Let's have a look at this pinch I'm talking about. Chelios may be one of the best in the league at doing this. He anticipates well, he gets off the mark well, and that's what sets up Savard right here. Look at it, just skates off his stick, and then goes wide as it hits hand and stick on the way through.
Denis Savard, original Hawks third overall pick in 1980, now 35 years old, and we wondered about how much longer he has left to play this game. He's wondering that himself. But Steve Armitage checking into the status of Tony Amonte, still waiting for word. Roenick blocked the outlet pass, then gives Proop a bit of a helmet rub as the Avalanche sent one back.
He had to jump pretty high to do that.
Bet Proop at 6'6". Stefaniel on Chris Chelios. Here come the Hawks. Big Eric Dazek to Savard and takes the puck back from him. To the point it goes to Suter. Untimed shot by Weinrich went wide. Side of the goal, centered in front, banging away at it as the penalty is over. And Gusarov out of the box cleared it, and the Hawks will change on that shoot-in.
An excellent penalty kill by the Avalanche.
2:35 to go, third period. Scott Young overskated the puck. Probert. Nice feed to Chance. Getting over there, though, was Lefebvre to get a stick in front of his shot. Knocked ahead by Hedmark. One-on-one second. As Young couldn't get the puck. Now Probert's away. Probert up with Murphy. Takes the puck. Nichols in the slot. Murphy fights off a check. Gusarov around the boards, but Carney's there first, pinching in deep. Keith Carney turns. He'll send one through. Into the slot to Murphy, and that just went wide through Gusarov's skates. Good thing it didn't hit his skate.
The Hawks are coming, they're pressuring, but they have to be very careful that they don't pressure too much.
Here's Murphy with two game-winning goals in the playoffs. Got that shot away. Patrick Waugh stopped it.
If they pressure too much, they won't have the third man high, and it'll cost them.
Here are the Avalanche quickly to center. Right wing pass for Claude Lemieux. Brent Sutter knocked him off stride. Sent back by Ozilinch, who was in deep on the play. And look out, three Hawks to center. Here's Sutter. Getting back though is Kaminsky to cover Savard. 1:20 to go, third period. A 3-3 tie, Hawks and Avalanche. Roenick the only goal in the third to tie up this game. Here's Peter Forsberg, who has a goal tonight. Around the net, centering in front. Comes back to him, puck still loose. Kaminsky on it. Forsberg going to provide some support on that side. Forsberg, what magic. Looks in front, that shot just missed. And the Hawks clear to the line, and it's past Krupen out the center.
And Brent Sutter just saved a goal right in the slot as he batted that puck away. Belfour was out of it. He was behind the net almost.
Less than a minute to go here in the third period. At center, Stefan Yell with Yell ahead to Ricci. Ricci stopped it. He is a goal tonight. Kriva Krasov turns. He's been stoned tonight by Patrick Roy. Kriva Krasov, the graduate from Red Army, across the line. Feeds one for Dazek. Half a minute to play in the third period. Kriva Krasov back in the net. Leaves it for Roenick. To Kriva Krasov again. Stefan Yell on him. Won't let him loose, sealing him against the boards. Now Dazek. He can't go anywhere, and Krupp will take it. Around the boards, Keane. Trying to tie it up there. The Avalanche would love to clear the zone if they can, and they do. As time winds down. And we're going to overtime. Just where game one went when Jeremy Roenick was the hero. As Chicago won the opener, so game three will go to overtime too.
Well, you almost had to think the way the goaltenders were playing, the way the intensity was in this hockey game, that maybe, just maybe, we'd look at overtime. It's been a very, very even game.
So these first 60 minutes have been great. We'll play some more. Now let's go to the broadcast center, Ron McLean and Don Cherry.
Thank you very much, Ken. Figure it out. They got a tie there, and you don't have a tie here.
Well, I give it to Cujol for Newmarket, his golf tournament.
Cujol.
Cujol.
No relation to Joe, as you know.
Oh, yeah. What do you want? Cujol.
Cujol. I thought you said Cujol. Anyway,
all right,
so you gave it to him, and he'll give it away
in
Newmarket.
Yeah, he's going to have a golf in a tournament, and I signed it for him and everything. Get a good guy. I have never in my life ever seen three or four games when we played against Toronto. Don't start crying, Toronto fans. Remember that a couple of years ago?
You know what? He was better against Chicago in the first round that year. He back-to-back shutouts. He buried the Blackhawks.
Cujol, which was your better series?
All right.
Toronto, he said. Toronto.
Well, what's he going to say? You gave him a tie.
Come on.
Remember you saw him when he was 14 years old?
14 years old. Somebody asked me to go out and take a look at this kid, and I went in. First shot, some guy wired it right in the top corner.
Al Wilson, he said.
That was his name?
His buddy,
anyhow, he was good. I knew he was going to be great there. And I was the first guy, I think, to use the one. When he was in St. Louis, he had more shots than anybody in the world. And I said he stopped more rubber than a dead skunk in the 401 highway. I said a cat, and then I got a lot of letters.
As usual. And, in fact, we've got a few to deal with in the next episode.
Stroglenite.
I'm amassing material from all over the country right now. You know, Darren Madeley, Joff Sargent, three goalies, Curtis Joseph, all from the same area. It's amazing.
Too bad about Amani.
Yeah, what was Hartsburg? I noticed you did pat him on the helmet.
You know, when I used to, even when Bobby get hurt, Brad Park, I never forgot that you put it right out of your mind. The guy, as far as you're concerned, is dead. You don't even think about him. And as Cujol said, you can't let on. It's bothering you. You don't even think of it. The guy is gone. Get him off. Get him out of there. And it's really tough, I'll tell you, when you have some friends do that too. But that's how, as a coach, that's how you think.
Will the Hawks, will they let down now? And if they can't use
him? You one guy that I really admire coming back is Pat Roy. After that goal, that guy was in the crease. That's one of the most blatant ones I ever saw. And for him to go in the dressing room and not go nuts and come back and get it all together, Cujol said that's the toughest thing of all. Knowing you got stiffed like that, now I'm asking you a question.
Good. Do I have an opinion? Yes.
Yes.
Ahead.
Now, can the guy upstairs, Cujol and I don't know this, can the guy upstairs say...
Video replay?
Yeah.
No.
Guy.
It is not. Do you have that, John, by chance? We do have that, the criteria for a video replay, but it's not one of them. Puck crossing the line, if the net's dislodged, end of the period, puck directed by a hand or foot, puck deflected off the official, puck struck by a high stick or to correct the time.
They should have had number 8 if a guy's in the crease or something like that, because that guy was right in the crease standing there and he could not see it. That's why he went nuts. But you know who I think missed it? I don't think Crawford saw it because he wasn't going bananas at the end.
Well, he might have underneath the stands. We don't know about that.
No, he was writing something in his book.
The other groceries or something. Criterion I'd like to add is one involving
I look like a priest here or what?
Audio replay. Yes, you'd be on the experts. By the way, I'm holding a copy of Peterborough Pete's.
Oh!
5 decades of hockey excellence. They beat Guelph Storm 8-7 in overtime tonight. All 7 games were won by the road team. Peterborough is the OHL champs.
And they're both in, but they give it the old college try or gold junior try, and that's a credit to them. Nobody let up. Nobody went through the motions just for the, you know, the memorial's coming up, and boy, that's going to be a great memorial in Peterborough.
Good. You got any tickets? Listen, we should show Roenick. Have you ever seen 4 Roenick. Goals? He scored 4. The prettiest one you'll ever see was just a moment ago, or was it?
Anaheim just said, put it up. Here it comes.
This is his OT winner, actually, from
game
1.
Stick on the ice. Stick on the ice. Watch this, kids. Stick on the ice. Get your stick on the ice. See his stick there? Stick on the ice. Boom. Most of you kids stand there with your stick in the air. You'd have never got it down there. Always, when you're around the net, have that stick on the ice.
He scored the tying goal with 8 seconds to go at Calgary, and the other goal he scored for me is the best one. It was when it was 1-0 in game 2 for Chicago. Calgary was playing really well. He shot the puck. It went wide, came off the boards. Came back, he got it himself.
Are you saying it was better than this one? This has got to be the prettiest goal of all time. Watch him go the old. What do you call that guy, the Russian that does this?
Nikolishin.
All right, Nikolishin. Whoa! They just said Anaheim just phoned his agent and said, put it up $1 million, because that's where I think he's going to go, Anaheim.
Yes.
Yes, I got inside stuff. Can you imagine him and Solani and Kariya and all that? It's going to be pretty good.
Ooh. Maybe Gretzky going there. Who knows?
Could be.
Overton, no way.
Just no.
Richard would know that. Overtime magic next. We'll celebrate some of the thoughts about how you approach OT when we continue with our coverage. It's tied in Chicago on Molson Hockey Night in Canada and the Stanley Cup playoffs in CBC.
Throughout the season, and then try and get them keyed up to handle whatever challenges they're going to face in the playoffs. And our team, I think, learned some valuable lessons last year. We learned that we didn't deal with adversity too well, whether it was injuries, whether it was being down in the series, whether it was calls that didn't go your way. All those things are part and parcel of what you have to deal with in playoff hockey, and the teams that deal with them the best, the teams that are mentally tough and teams that handle that adversity, for the most part, are the teams that do well in the playoffs. Obviously, you need a certain amount of skill and a certain amount of talent to go with that, but in our group, we have that.
First lead for the Avalanche in the game. Now Claude Lemieux's on the move. Lemieux trying to break through. Here's a shot. They score! Kaminsky!
I really believe that if your team is fundamentally very sound and has very good working habits and very good effort and execution each and every time out, that's going to be the base that you're going to be able to fall back on each and every time. So we've tried to work that process throughout the season with our eyes set on the big prize at the end, knowing that if we have good habits, that's probably our best way to challenge for the big prize.
Here's Sakic in the zone. Bad angle. They jam at it. Hirsch down. Oh, and now that stay out. Looks like it hit the goalpost. Ozilich drops it back. Bad angle. They score. Joey Sakic's done it again.
I think prayer in overtime is probably the biggest thing for coaches. You want your team to play well, you want them to perform well, but oftentimes it's in the hands of a more powerful being, whether that's Patrick Waugh or somebody else. You really have to rely on your habits, your work habits, and try to play the consistent brand of hockey, whether you're playing in the first minute of the game or in the 40th minute of overtime. I really believe that it comes down to the team that makes less mistakes usually is the team that wins. The team that's closer to form more often than not is the team that ends up on the positive side of the score.
Overtime Magic, brought to you by B.F. Goodrich. Show them
for Chicago. Already in the playoffs. As overtime is underway. The Avalanche to our right, the Hawks to our left. And it's flipped out to the Colorado line. Lefebvre quickly off the boards, down to the Chicago blue line. Chelios gets it ahead, whacked by Chance, off the boards and into the Colorado zone. Sandis Ozelinch turns with it. Gets it around to Lefebvre. Remember, Roenick was hero in game one of this series. And that's an offside pass to Forsberg. Colorado's three losses have all been by one goal in the playoffs. And if they lose tonight, it would be as well. We mentioned the all-time overtime goal scoring. There you see Joe Murphy with four and has scored two overtime goals as a Blackhawk of the four in his career. And has won in triple overtime against the Calgary Flames. Murphy always says, I'm a big-time player and proving it with big-time goals.
I'll tell you, Hertzberg has been telling him the whole playoffs, too. You told me you were a big-time player in the playoffs. Go out and do it.
You know,
he's been doing it so far.
First overall pick of Detroit in 86, an NCAA champion with Michigan State, won a Calder Cup with Adirondack, a Stanley Cup with the Oilers in 90. He's a winner. Sent ahead to Daze, leaving it Kriva Krasov. Shot scores! Win.
Hawks win 46 seconds in. The Molson Three stars are Roenick, Murphy, and Forsberg.
Is this offside?
Let's have a look. We'll have to look really slowly.
All right, now see if it's offside.
No.
Okay, now look at a guy sticks his stick out. All you young defensemen, never was a guy taking a shot, dive like that, and stick your stick out. Patrick Waugh had that. He had the whole thing. He was down there. He had the butterfly, the whole thing. Hit the stick, threw him off in the top corner. Never stick that stick. Brian Hayworth and I were talking about that before. Cheevers, anybody you talk to, never, ever stick your stick out.
And when you're the last man back, I die for that defenseman. That's quite a development, obviously. 46 seconds in, the Hawks take the series lead, 2-1. Tomorrow evening, Philadelphia is at Florida at 7:30 Eastern. We'll be downtown shopping for ties. This one's been resolved. Thanks for watching this evening for all of us. Good night.